believe that we are already 9+ months into this year. It makes my head spin. It's hard to believe that we're about to see another anniversary of the September 11th attacks coming up in just a few days. It will be the 15th anniversary of those tragic events that changed our world, but did not make us any safer with the police state that followed suit. I didn't get to it yesterday, but I'm going to get to it today because it dovetails with Gary Johnson falling flat on his face and not knowing what Aleppo is. But it ties into a Mark Dice report, Americans completely clueless about 9/11 15 years later. And whereas you can be very sad for these ignorant people or also be very scared of them because they're so dangerous, like a school of piranha or a pack of lemmings running over you and dragging you with them over the side of a cliff. But you have to understand, this is the ocean. This is the atmosphere. This is the ether. This is the elixir. This is the universe. This is the domain. The ecosystem in which the parasite globalists thrive. And the dumbed-down population is our mortal enemy. But it's an enemy that we can hopefully try to somehow find some humanity in and take back from the brink of total psychological and spiritual oblivion. Obviously, the big story on DrudgeReport.com, the big giant link there under the banner head of Hillary's Medusa-like Gorgon head, Hillary and the ear pearl. And she undoubtedly has an earpiece in her ear. It was about 10 o'clock at night. I was already going to bed early last night, exhausted. And Joe Big starts texting me, bzz, bzz. Look at this earpiece. And I said, absolutely, go with it. Rolled over, went to sleep. Got up this morning at 6 a.m., went in, got some breakfast, saw the kids off of school. Went in, punched up the computer, top of DrudgeReport.com. Paul Joseph Watson's lengthy article detailing this. But she 100% has a earbud. And you can see it on the video, but not as clearly as photos. Like, I've got one here on my phone that Biggs texted me last night where it's an HD photo, and you can see that it is, looks like a hearing aid, actually. The point is, they're mum on it so far. Clearly, the smoking gun evidence is the WikiLeaks documents, as usual, with her girlfriend, Uma Abedin. I'm sorry, the woman that stays in the same bed with her, in the same hotel rooms. Her confidant, her friend, whose mother is the foremost promoter in the world of cutting women's genitals off. I mean, you can't make that up. It's just a little added cherry to throw in. We have the email from her saying, hey, did you forget your earpiece? Or do you need me to bring you your earpiece for the speech you're going to be giving? So Hillary does have an earpiece, has used an earpiece. This is clearly an earpiece. And the question is, how is Hillary going to spin this? So we have the man Paul Watson on Monday called a complete idiot, Gary Johnson being a complete idiot. You know, I figured it out. Gary Johnson is like an 80 IQ. We're going to talk about that as well. Stay with us. Ladies and gentlemen, this September 8th, Thursday, worldwide transmission is going to be jam-packed. The persecuted political prisoner, Dinesh D'Souza, will join us to break down his view on 2016 and all the big developments. We're also going to have Leanne McAdoo, Owen Schroyer, and, of course, Anthony Gucciardi in here hosting a roundtable discussion in the last hour and a half of the broadcast. We'll have Joe Biggs and others popping in as well. I intend to open the phones up in the first half of the broadcast, obviously today, and take your phone calls because I imagine you want to comment on that so-called forum last night where they attempted to rig things for Hillary Clinton, but again, it blew up in her face. She has the opposite of a Midas touch. Whatever she touches disintegrates. Huge developments on that front. We also have Gary Johnson, who I've been trying to figure out for a while, getting hit with a zinger. And these are the type of questions that I'm worried about with Trump when they bring up something like, what's Aleppo? Well, it's the most war-torn city in Syria. It's where the most lives have been lost. The city is kind of like the Leningrad or Stalingrad of Russia, where it just goes back and forth on both sides. And the war was basically decided in Leningrad, then Stalingrad, changing the name. Now St. Petersburg today. But the point is, that's what Aleppo is. It's the most war-torn battlefront of the Syrian conflict. And this morning, I turned on the TV, and Gary Johnson's in a controversy, couldn't answer a Syria question. And I just knew it'd be something like, what's the most war-torn city? Because reporters can act smart doing that and have all the factoids beforehand. And sure enough, I said, Aleppo. And they come back from break. They go to the clip. It was Aleppo. It's scary when you know the enemy as good as I do. It's crazy when you know what they're going to do before they do it. But really, it's not even that crazy. That's a good question, actually, to see if you have knowledge about the Syrian conflict, which I have studied for hundreds and hundreds of hours. I've interviewed probably over 100 top guests, and I have trouble keeping track of it. I mean, it is a spaghetti mess. I mean, it is like a knotted, twisted, crazy, confusing, out-of-control situation. But if you don't know what Aleppo is, that you've got a major, major problem. If you don't know what Damascus is, you've got a major, major problem. That's the ancient capital of Syria and the second oldest continual Christian community. On and on and on. They don't know these factoids. And that's the thing about Gary Johnson. When he was here the last time in the studio, I was being very polite, very nice to him because I'd known the guy for a decade before, interviewed him in person many times, been in a few functions, even sat at the same table with him. And I always thought he was kind of boring, had no personality. But he was very hateful the last time he was here and almost hissing at me during breaks and very angry, like he does blowing up at reporters now if they question him. And now I realize it's because he's a pseudo-intellectual buffoon. When Paul Watson shot a video on Monday saying that he is a complete idiot, I said, you know, I don't know if he's a complete idiot. Maybe a sociopath, no conscience. But now I realize Paul's right. That's why he gets so mad. You look at him, he's a bumbling moron. Gary Johnson is a bumbling idiot. And any so-called libertarian that supports him is not a libertarian. Anti-gun VP, he's now anti-gun, wants open borders, wants corporate welfare, wants privatized prisons, total corporate welfare. It's for the TPP. Amnesty, I mean, he's for the whole New World Order agenda. The fawning mainstream media is supporting him and having LA Times headlines and New York Times headlines. This is the man that could hand it to Hillary Clinton. Absolutely. So that's why I've been hammering him, and it's good to see him basically blow his feet off because he didn't even try to say, can you elaborate? He just said, what is Aleppo? That's coming up. But obviously, the big story. The ongoing crashing and burning of Herr Hitlery. If you go to drudgereport.com, you can see the big, giant main headline under her ignoble brow, Hillary and the ear pearl. And the minute I saw this last night, I didn't notice it during the forum, Joe Big sent me a HD photo, and it's clearly an earpiece. And we show TV viewers the actual article. It's an HD photo. I want to show people that. You can see that it's clearly an earpiece on the Infowars.com story. And the minute I looked at it, I said, boom, clearly this is going on. This is Hillary basically being given her walking orders if she can't answer one of these questions that comes from the crowd. She didn't have to worry about Matt Lauer, who works as part of the Global Clinton Initiative and is a darling of the Clintons. Oh, no. Didn't have to worry about that at all. Now, another big piece of evidence that James Woods pointed out was that WikiLeaks, back in 2009, released an email from Hillary, which Hillary admits is real, or to Hillary, from Huma Abedin, her confidant. Did you take your earpiece or do I need to get it? So if they come out and say that this is a hearing aid, we know they're lying because they're calling it an earpiece, and an earpiece is the term for a tiny radio transmitter receiver that picks up audio transmissions when she's in a jam. And the Clintons, Steve Pachenik had talked about this months ago on the show. In fact, we got to find the clip. He said, are well known to use earpieces. So you talk about cheating. You talk about staging something. You talk about manipulation. This is it in a big, big way. So the article is an Infowars.com report. Was Hillary wearing an earpiece during last night's presidential forum? Paul Joseph Watson, conservative actor James Woods, says she can't even lie without help. And then it goes through the evidence of it. Of even more concern, it's now confirmed in the Hill newspaper. Steve Watson's reporting on it at Infowars.com. Hillary campaign is pressuring media not to cover her health issues. No kidding. If someone mentions it on a TV show now, they cut the feed. If Trump mentions it, they cut the feed. They are clearly scared to death of this because this woman has serious health problems. And that's what Paul Joseph Watson reports on. Dem strategists fear Hillary's health questions could cost her the election. Advisors panicked over viral controversy. She clearly looks like hell. She's clearly got some gentleman, a black man, that follows her around with an tranquilizer pen. And then when someone stands up in a crowd and just barely says something to her, she starts panicking and bumbling around. And he has to say, it's okay, it's okay, keep talking. And then she goes from looking completely insane, focuses back down again, and looks somewhat normal. I mean, this is what you'd imagine in a movie where you show someone starting to flip out, going crazy, how they'd look. And then when they come back to reality with a totally different face, she looks like someone out of a mental institution. Why do people have to jump to her side and say everything's okay? Now, before I go back to the full clip of that, I want to go to Joe Biggs and get his firsthand observations of this and how he first noticed this, as a lot of other people were spontaneously noticing it last night. And then he put out the term, hashtag Hillary's earpiece, that's now going viral. So Joe Biggs for Infowars.com, they're in the control room. What was your first approximation when you saw this? And then now what's your view on it?
Well, the interesting thing about the forum last night, the not so much debate, was the fact that she would sit down and stand up and kind of walk around, pacing around. It was really odd. I was like, what is she doing? And when I got back home after we were covering the forum, I started seeing some pictures, and I zoomed in close on one of them. I saw this look like a pearl or an earpiece in her ear. So I simply took that picture, tweeted it out, and I said, you know, this looks suspicious. Is this an earpiece? Who's talking to her? Hashtag Hillary's earpiece. You know, and it really started a conversation. That hashtag's gotten over 73,000 comments on it, I believe, so far. And it's actually one of the top searches on Google right now. So, you know, who's talking to her? Who's feeding her this information, if that's what's happening? And I think Donald Trump should bring some kind of jamming device next time he goes on stage when he has to meet her one-on-one to make her actually be honest.
That's a really good point. I've always predicted that they're going to try to weasel out of a real debate with Trump, because if he's in a real debate with her on the stage and has any time to respond, he's going to savage her with the truth. It's going to be devastating. The ratings, I would imagine, even though they're burying it, you know, during NFL football games, are going to be 50, 60 million viewers, almost as big as the Super Bowl. This is going to be epic. And I don't see how they can put her up there when, again, if you've missed it, she has this mysterious guy for months with her who disappeared for a few weeks. He's now back. They won't say who he is. He's got an EpiPen or some type of injector pen right beside her, and he has to tell her, it's okay, keep talking. Let's play the clip.
Keep talking, you handle it, we're not going to.
But Trump's response.
Okay, here we are.
And this is the guy that orders the Secret Service around, but is not
okay.
Secret Service.
We'll keep talking.
Understand this. Secret Service doesn't touch Hillary. Unless she's being shot at, then they jump on her. And the press has asked who this is, and they won't say. And now she's finally had one staged press conference, I'm going to skip this break, where she had a coughing fit, and had to stop that with just 8 or 9 sycophantic women there. Now she's had another one that no one knew was about to happen this morning with like 6 or 7 other people with staged questions. This woman has serious problems. And I saw that last night because I had one channel on with the Raw debate and then the other channel on with our analysis of it in live time. And I noticed she kept pacing back and forth very, very strangely, like she was listening to something. And it just looked like she was crazy. And it makes perfect sense. That's what someone looks like when they're waiting and listening to be able to finish their answer. Joe Biggs.
Well, if you look at the responses that Trump had after Matt Lauer would ask a question, it was very fluid. It was a normal conversation. Now, when Matt Lauer was addressing Hillary Clinton, she would kind of sit there, nod her head for a minute. There would be an awkward pause, and then she would respond, which makes complete and total sense. It's somebody's feeding her something. Is it Huma Abedin, or maybe it's one of the highest people who have donated money to her that they're allowed to talk to her. It could be George Soros or one of those demon goblin babies that she coughed up out of there that hatched. I mean, I have no idea, but someone's feeding her information, and it was very awkward. You can tell last night that it didn't seem like a normal conversation, that she was definitely being fed something.
You're right, Joe. And of course, you made a satirical comment there about Hillary Clinton gives birth to bizarre creatures. That's the video blown up of the green globulates and weird brown fluid coming out of her mouth. We've blown this up, and it doesn't look like cough drops. Who has, swamp green, large globulates coming out with brown fluid? How could she even talk with two of these big lozenges in her mouth? We're not literally saying that these were, you know, demon eggs or something, but this is so, again, emblematic of just how disgusting this woman is.
Well, another word on the street is a lot of the press corps that travel around with her know that if they ask any kind of difficult questions to her, that there's a good chance that they're going to be kicked off the plane and not allowed to follow around anymore and report on stuff.
Well, I have to say, the one veteran that got a good question into her about the fact that he was in the military with classified information, and that if he'd have done this, he'd be in jail. He was shaking. He's a grown man, combat vet, and he's up there shaking when he asked her that question because that's how much fear people have of this lady. But I have to say, the forum was better than I thought it would be. It was horrible to have Matt Lauer. He didn't disclose that he, you know, basically works with and for the Clintons. Normally, when you see News Corp or another major media outlet reporting on their own stock, reporting on their own activities, they'll tell you that, you know, News Corp is the parent company, say, of Fox, or Time Warner is the parent company, or was, of CNN. They don't do that now. It's unprecedented.
Well, she opened up last night with the whole fact that she did not send or receive any emails with any kind of classification markings whatsoever. And she's still running with that narrative that's already been proven false, that we do know that she did that. We do know that she received emails with classifications. Then she comes out and says she doesn't know what the C means. And this guy, who was a high level military person at one time, who had a security clearance, he knew that if he would have done something like that, or if I would do something like that, we'd be in jail. This shows clearly that she is above and beyond the law.
That's right. In fact, I want to play that clip. It's on Infowars.com. Vet confronts Clinton. I would have been prosecuted for mishandling intel. U.S. Navy veteran confronted Hillary Clinton during the Commander-in-Chief Forum Wednesday over the handling of controversial information. It's beyond confidential. It's secret. Here it is.
Secretary Clinton, thank you very much for coming tonight. As a naval flight officer, I held a top secret sensitive compartmentalized information clearance, and that provided me access to materials and information highly sensitive to our warfighting capabilities. Had I communicated this information not following prescribed protocols, I would have been prosecuted and imprisoned. Secretary Clinton, how can you expect those such as myself, who were and are entrusted with America's most sensitive information, to have any confidence in your leadership as president when you clearly corrupted our national security?
Well, I appreciate your concern and also your experience, but let me try to make the distinctions that I think are important for me to answer your question. First, as I said to Matt, you know and I know, classified material is designated, it is marked, there is a header, so that there is no
enough. We have the emails where she ordered
what is being
and her staff ordered the cutting off of those. And WikiLeaks has reported 2 days ago, Julian Assange, that next week or within a week, they're going to release thousands of emails that were secret, that she deleted, where she knew it was clearly top secret and confidential. So, again, she's about to be proven as a total and complete liar. Let me ask you this question, Joe Biggs. What do you expect her handlers to do to try to pull her bacon out of the fire?
I don't think there's anything that can take her down, really. I mean, I believe that we could literally have proof of her being connected to the murders of one of these people in the Clinton body counter, actual footage of her doing it, and they would still give her a pass. The media would still go, oh, well, she had a bad day, or maybe, you know, they would find any way they could to get her out of it. At this point in time, she's unstoppable. But the populace is most people in America, they want Trump. If you look at the polls after the forum last night, everyone liked Trump. I mean, people see through her lies, but they're going to continue. CNN, MSNBC, Fox News now, they're all going to continue to try to push this Clinton narrative that she's this doll, she's going to be this first woman president, and she's going to be the one that helps usher us into this new era.
All right, Joe, thank you for your analysis. I think it's spot on from the perspective if we're going with the mainstream media. And I think this is a very, very key time, a battle right now between the forces of the new media and the populist movement worldwide and folks that do still tune into mainstream media. If enough people tune into mainstream media and believe that narrative that she's going to be the winner, they can steal it, and enough people will go along with it where they can effectively do that. Thank you, Joe Biggs. Now, continuing down this line, and I'm going to pull these photos up because they were viral at the time, and Drudge carried it. We covered it at the time. You would want a search engine, George W. Bush mysterious earpiece. And he clearly had an earpiece in, and he clearly had some type of transmitter booster pack on his back, and he had a wire leading up through the suit up to the earpiece, which was then a wireless earbud. So I would imagine that that's what was going on here. So there is a precedent. And so Joe Biggs was asking, you know, who knows who would be popping into her ear? I guarantee you this. It is the very same type shadow government people that were feeding into George W. Bush's ear so he wouldn't get stumped on not doing his homework and not knowing the name of major cities like Aleppo. And speaking of the devil, I want to go to the Gary Johnson information now. I don't have a bone to pick with Gary Johnson, the individual, except that I've known him for 10 years, had him in studio at least 5-6 times that I can remember, had him on the radio as a guest another 10 times or so. And the last time he was here, he acted like he hated my guts during the breaks, was bugging his eyes out at me, kind of like he blew up at the town hall reporter, just out of the blue in, you know, 1 millisecond on a dime. But I pointed out he seems really stupid, but also very arrogant, you know, the type of fop you'd expect to find in some, you know, country club that thinks they're God and smarter than everyone. Though he's got the energy level of a block of, you know, cheese. Well, he went on NBC, MSNBC, and they ask him, what is Aleppo? He goes, I don't know. What is Aleppo? All he's got's gimmicks where he wears a suit and tie, but, you know, wears Nike tennis shoes. It's all a big joke. And so this is really blown up in his face because he's a pseudo-intellectual. He supposedly knows everything, and he doesn't know anything. He supports the TPP. He says Hillary is a, quote, great humanitarian, a great public servant is the actual quote. So let's go ahead and go to the clip of Gary Johnson.
What would you do if you were elected about Aleppo?
About?
Aleppo.
And what is Aleppo?
You're kidding.
No.
Aleppo is in Syria. It's the epicenter of the refugee crisis.
Okay, got it. Got it.
Okay.
Well, with regard to Syria, I do think that it's a mess. I think that the only way we deal with Syria is to join hands with Russia to diplomatically bring that at an end. But when we've aligned ourselves with, when we've supported the opposition, the Free Syrian Army, is also coupled with the Islamists, and then the fact that we're also supporting the Kurds, and this is, it's just a mess. And that this is the result of regime change that we end up supporting. And inevitably, these regime changes have led to a less safe world. So yeah.
Now, most of the media is not actually playing the whole clip where he gives a somewhat decent answer. But you have to understand, this is why Hillary has an earpiece, because she doesn't want to be caught in a faux pas like this. All right, stay with us. I'm Alex Jones, InfoWars.com. Monday through Friday, from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Central, we're here live. Back weeknights, 7 o'clock Central. Find showtimes, affiliates, details at InfoWars.com/show. Or go to InfoWars.com and just click the Listen Media tag to find all of that information. And then hopefully take that information and send those links, those stories, those podcast links, the free iPhone and Droid app links to friends, family, neighbors, people in your community that you want to wake up. Whatever you do, whether it's reaching out to complete strangers or calling your grandma up on the phone, now is the time to really hit the streets and to put our walking boots on, to quote Nigel Farage, and to get aggressive, because the 21st century information war against the globalist attempted conquest is on. Now, before I go any further, there's a lot of other news obviously going on that we tend to not get to as much because we're so busy focusing on the incredible nature of this campaign. It's less than 60 days now until the election. What an incredible time to be alive right now. 59 and a half days until that election kicks off. You could cut the tension in the air with a knife. And world economic collapse rolling out. Big Brother on steroids rolling out. Attacks on the family rolling out. This article's up on InfoWars.com. New ID badge records employees' conversations. Your boss can now monitor you 1984 style. Then that ties into exclusive from InfoWars.com. Bill Clinton claims Make America Great Again slogan is racist, but used the phrase officially in 1991 as his campaign slogan, right through to 92, 93. We've got a bunch of clips of that. City to fine residents over puddles of water in response to Zika. We're going to look more at what Trump is actually proposing and what Hillary is proposing. It's all coming up today and your phone calls. The toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. Now, September is preparedness month, and I can't offer this special throughout the month. I can offer it until the middle of next week or so. But just one of the specials is 30 to 40% off the super high-quality storable foods that are already discounted at InfoWarsStore.com. We have the entire line of My Patriot Supply that is the best quality at the very lowest prices out there you're going to find. And this is just private labeled, so we can contractually go down even more, 30 to 40% off depending on which package. But the minimum is 30% off the already super low prices. And the profit we do make funds this operation, so it's a win-win. 20% off Survival Shield Nascent Iodine X2, the good halogen that's so essential in the body. 20% off the Vitamin Mineral Fusion Fruit Punch system that everybody should be drinking every day. And it replaces, you know, all the high fructose corn syrup soda drinks and the rest of it. And it supports the broadcast. We have the new BioTrue Selenium that is going to sell out very, very soon. First run of it is very, very popular. Already is getting 5 stars, but not for 2 weeks. BioTrue Selenium, the strongest, purest that we could find. We believe it's the best out there. It is from the mustard seed. It ties in with Survival Shield X2. It ties in with vitamin C. These three things all go together. We don't sell vitamin C because there's so many really good forms of it available just in fruits and vegetables. Not the case with BioTrue Selenium, not the case with Survival Shield X2, True Nascent Iodine. This is just not the case. So these are things that people absolutely need, and your purchase funds this operation. Also, I don't claim to be, again, a beach boy, but I gained almost 100 pounds in the first 15 years I was on air because I just quit working out. And then the last 6 years or so, I've slowly lost more than 80 pounds of fat, and I gained a lot of muscle. But overall, I'm about 50 pounds lighter than I was. And in fact, we got some new photos that I'll later in the broadcast show. I mean, I've got a big head, big chest, big shoulders, so I'm a big guy. But before Cleveland, I got down to the beginnings of a six-pack, gained about 10 pounds during Cleveland, and the weeks after that, I quit working out for a while. But the point is, I was working out 6 years ago harder than I am now and wasn't losing weight. And it was because I was missing the key things like the proper iodine, selenium. It's just amazing what ended up happening. So and my journey really accelerated about 3-4 years ago. That's when I lost the majority of this weight. And then just since a year ago, my muscle mass has gone way up. I've gotten so much more healthy. But we're showing some photos from a year ago. We've got a bunch of new ones, and I'm going to get a new video out that shows that. Because that says now. That's about 3-4 months ago. I'm in even better shape than that now. So, again, they always say it's not even so much exercise, it's diet. And absolutely, once I had the trace elements and the minerals and the good halogen in my body, it was a dramatic change in stamina, in libido, in energy. Super Male Vitality, X2, things like selenium, a good multivitamin mineral that I get through the Vitamin Mineral Fusion or from InfoWars Health. Beyond Tangy Tangerine, the longevity product is excellent as well. All available at InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsTeam.com. In fact, we're rebuilding InfoWarsHealth.com, so the place to go is InfoWarsTeam.com for the great longevity line of products. InfoWarsLife.com products, of course, are developed by us. So whether it's colloidal silver or whether it's Living Defense, Parasite Cleanse, or DNA Force, or Sleep Aids, or high-quality organic Mediterranean oregano. It's all available at InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsTeam.com, or you can simply call toll free 888-253-3139. Now, getting back into the news here, Gary Johnson put his foot in his mouth. This is the type of thing I'm worried about with Donald Trump, where they'll use some factoid, some city, some town, some little piece of information to make you look stupid. And the truth is, Johnson's a globalist. He's a sellout. He thinks everything of himself. He gave a quasi-okay question, but not knowing the main war-torn city, the main battleground, not knowing the deciding city in the six-year conflict is stupid. But he did have a decent answer after that, though it was kind of all discombobulated. But that's why Hillary's got an earpiece. And that's why George W. Bush clearly had an earpiece, because they don't know all these facts and all this information either. And so they've got to have a panel of experts sitting there. And I've talked to insiders, I mean, the people that actually know what's going on. They say there's up to four people sitting there ready to pop in with the correct answer for her. So it's like a rigged game show. There's been famous cases of game shows in the 40s, the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s being rigged. With people, with earpieces, being told what to do or being given the questions beforehand. And so this is very, very legitimate to bring this up. And it shows that crooked Hillary will go to no ends. Donald Trump Jr. Tweeted out our story this morning as well. Everybody else should retweet Paul Joseph Watson's story. Everybody should go to drudgereport.com and get it and send it to local radio, local TV. Send it to local papers and say, why aren't you reporting on this? Because she's clearly got an earpiece in her ear. Now, watch. In fact, as of airtime 40 minutes ago, I haven't been online since then, there have been no response from Hillary. This is one of the top trending items on Twitter, Facebook, Google, one of the top stories in the world, probably be the top story, because Drudge is linked to it as his top story. How big will this get? We're going to take your phone calls coming up here in a few minutes. The toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. We're going to go to callers, George and Austin and Gene and Eileen and John and others coming up here in a few minutes. But first, if you just joined us, here is the type of zinger I'm worried about they're going to throw at Trump because he doesn't have an earpiece and Hillary does. Here's Johnson falling on his face.
What would you do if you were elected
about Aleppo?
About
Aleppo.
And what is Aleppo?
You're kidding.
No.
Aleppo is in Syria. It's the epicenter of the refugee crisis.
Okay, got it. Got it.
Okay.
Joe.
Okay, that's
so
good.
Aleppo.
Now let's go ahead and go to Mark Dice's report from yesterday that's still on the front page of PrisonPlanet.com and Infowars.com, where I want to be clear, because we do the very same reports. He's a contributor to Infowars. We're not going out. Infowars isn't going out. Mark Dice isn't going out to try to make people look stupid. We're going out with horror to show how ill-informed they are. The majority of Americans don't know the three branches of government. They don't know the basics of anything. Most Americans will say ban water in surveys if you say it's for the environment to ban dihydrogen monoxide. We're pointing out this ignorance is here so that something can be done about it. This is not edited. I mean, it's cut down for brevity, but Mark Dice, and so do we show you when we go out and do this in Austin, Texas, or in other parts of the country when our crew's on the road, this is what we're getting. The majority of Californians he talks to want to kill children up to age 3, post-birth abortion. About half of Austinites do. 9 out of 10 Californians want to put gun owners in forced labor camps and seize our assets. These people are dangerous, and that's why we're showing them to you. And then this is the type of low-information voter that Gary Johnson hopes you are when he says the TPP is a great deal, or when his neocon warmongering associate wants to ban all guns that hold more than 5 rounds of ammunition. And he claims you take the pin out of a rifle to make it automatic. You take the pin out, the firing pin out, so it doesn't work anymore, dummy. So a lot of these politicians are just kind of mediocre yes men. And then their minions are even stupider. Let's go to the folks that Gary Johnson is so popular in California right now. Here it is.
What was the name of the organization that Osama bin Laden ran?
I don't know.
You don't know. What was the name of the terrorist leader behind the 9/11 attacks?
Saddam. Oh, wait, I always pronounce it wrong, but it's Saddam Hussein or something.
What is the man's name that was behind the September 11th attacks, like the big terrorist leader? What was his name?
I don't know.
You don't know. What was the name of the terrorist leader behind the 9/11 attacks?
Don't remember. Saddam Hussein?
No.
Saddam Hussein?
I don't know. I thought this was going to be fun, and you just made this all serious.
No, life is actually very serious.
Yeah, I know. It's really sad stuff, but I'm at the beach.
Just giving you a reality check today.
Oh, geez. Okay.
What country were most of the terrorists from that committed the 9/11 attacks?
Iraq. Iran, Syria,
nope.
Middle East.
Nope. Well, that's a region. What year did the 9/11 attacks happen?
2003.
What did the terrorist attacks of 9/11 start? What was the result of that?
A lot of people being scared about terrorists.
It was the beginning of the
war on Syria.
The war on Iraq.
Before the Iraq war. There's something else. That was 2 years later.
2 years later, after 9/11.
It started the war on terror.
Oh,
we were looking for the war on terror.
The war on terror. Okay.
And then was the Iraq war.
Okay.
Okay, 2 years later. Other than the Twin Towers, what other building got hit on 9/11?
I think it started with an E.
With an E?
Yeah. I don't know the name of it.
Okay. What was some of the targets of the 9/11 terrorist attacks?
I don't know. I want to get a beer, man.
What year did the 9/11 attacks happen?
I'm good, man.
What's the answer?
I'm good.
What terrorist organization was behind the terrorist attacks?
I'm going to guess ISIS, but I feel like that's wrong.
Yeah, that's... Oh, gosh. Who was the terrorist leader behind the 9/11 attacks?
They say it was Osama bin Laden. Oh. But do we really know which facet of, you know...
That, this guy's thinking.
That's what they say.
Okay. Uh-huh. That's, no, this man is thinking here. Let that sink in there for a minute, people.
That's what they say. Who knows? That's who the government pinned it on.
Good for you, bro.
Anything else?
I'm not trying to be stereotypical, but it's overwhelmingly Italians don't trust the government and know what's going on. Now, I know some Italians that are dumber than a box of rocks as well. I mean, every group has morons, but it's just funny that guy's got a big, you know, I'm an Italian tattoo on his arm, and he's the only person out there that could even have any inkling of what planet we were living on. And that's what's frightening about this. I don't take pleasure in the fact the general public is really stupid. And they revel in it. Like that one guy said, I don't care. I want a beer. Your ancestors fought and died and were as tough as nails so you'd have a little bit of freedom and a little bit of free market and this prosperity. And then these people sit there thinking it's going to go on forever when the globalists are the biggest sharks the world has ever seen. And that's why they do things like this. Hillary, last night, we have the clip coming up, told the folks at the Commander-in-Chief Forum, the veterans, that, quote, we did not lose a single American in Libya. She's gotten in trouble for saying that over and over again for 4 years. She did it again because it's on purpose. We lost 4 Americans. Upwards of 80,000 Libyans have now been killed by the war you triggered, bringing in Al-Qaeda, now known as ISIS. So that's how stupid she thinks you are. That's a Breitbart article. We have the clip. But remember, her constituents do not know what planet they're on, have no idea what Benghazi is. That's why she said famously in the Senate Armed Services Committee, when they asked about the Turkish ambassador, she said, Turkey? What are we talking about? Turkey birds? You know, again. But I tell you, John Bowne, one of our investigative journalists, has knocked it out of the park again. With the fact that, hey, they're openly trying to rig the election in front of everybody, we got to keep this front and center. Here's John Bowne.
In one of the most blatant pieces of propaganda in U.S. history, the Washington Post wants to sell America on the idea that the upcoming rigged elections by Obama and the DHS will be blamed solely on Vladimir Putin.
Of course the elections will not be rigged. What does that mean?
This is a kind of fundamental attack on the country itself, the underpinning of it, that somehow or another it's rigged or it's not fair. People, you know, some people don't believe that. The truth of that is, Chuck can attest to this too, by and large, American elections are pretty much on the up and up.
The Washington Post writes, U.S. intelligence and law enforcement agencies are probing what they see as a broad covert Russian operation in the United States to sow public distrust in the upcoming presidential election and in U.S. political institutions. The aim is to understand the scope and intent of the Russian campaign, which incorporates cyber tools to hack systems used in the political process, enhancing Russia's ability to spread disinformation. The effort to better understand Russia's covert influence operations is being spearheaded by James R. Clapper Jr., the director of National Intelligence. This is something of concern for the DNI, said Charles Allen, a former longtime CIA officer who has been briefed on some of these issues. It is being addressed. The official cautioned that the intelligence community is not saying it has definitive proof of such tampering or any Russian plans to do so. But even the hint of something impacting the security security of our election system would be of significant concern, the official said. It's the key to our democracy that people have confidence in the election system. Let me get this straight. The American people are to place the future of our country in the hands of National Intelligence Director James Clapper, the same man that blatantly misled the American people when he lied to Congress regarding the total dragnet our intelligence community wields on the supposed protections of our Bill of Rights.
Does the NSA collect any type of data at all on millions or hundreds of millions of Americans?
No, sir.
It does not.
Not wittingly.
Now, why do you say he was lying there?
Because the letter that he sent to Congress admitted that they roam through the content of phone calls and the content of emails and the content of text messages without a warrant, in direct contradiction to what he said to that Senate committee.
I do think that when history looks at this, they're going to contrast the behavior of James Clapper, our National Intelligence Director, with Edward Snowden. Mr. Clapper lied in Congress in defiance of the law in the name of security. Mr. Snowden told the truth in the name of privacy.
And the DHS is going to overrule powers given to local and state governments to manage their own elections under Article 1, Section 4 of the U.S. Constitution, not to mention the powers afforded states in the 10th Amendment, simply because DHS claims to be able to provide ironclad cybersecurity. Thousands of DHS employees were subjected to, as WorldNet Daily recently reported, the theft of Social Security numbers, dates of birth, residencies, educational and employment histories, personal foreign travel histories, immediate families, business and personal acquaintance details, and other information used to conduct background clearances. A mountain of evidence containing decades of collusion between our government and an elitist banking cabal sits collecting dust. Meanwhile, the American people are supposed to believe with zero proof that a foreign government will hack our elections, and that for the first time in U.S. history, the electoral process must be hijacked by a dictatorial administration hanging on to the last remnants of its power before they are shown the door. John Bound for InfoWars.com.
Do people notice history when it's happening right in front of them? Stay with us. I'm Alex Jones. Second hour, straight ahead.
Thank you for listening to GCN.
It's hour three, hour four. Spread the word.
Visit GCNLive.com. It's an info war. Today.
It's a war. A war. We've got a lot coming up today. Dinesh D'Souza, Leanne McAdoo, Mr. Scheuer, and others in studio. I want to go to your phone calls throughout this hour, intersperse it with a lot of other news that is obviously unfolding. Gene in New Mexico wants to talk about Clinton's earpiece in the election. We'll go to Gene in the next segment. We've got Austin wants to talk about third term for Obama. George wants to talk about Hillary could die in office. What would happen? That's an important question. We've got Al wants to talk about Trump in the election. Scottish John wants to talk about Lord Monckton. The toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231. Obviously, I'll recap some of the top stories against the news I haven't covered a little bit later in the hour, but the big story is Hillary wearing the earpiece. And what'd you think of the forum? It was an hour long. Forum was usually 2 or 3 hours long, and then hit an earpiece in, and the whole thing was staged with Matt Lauer, her minion that works for her, asking the questions. He didn't disclose that. Pretty crazy. So let's go ahead and go to Austin in Oklahoma. You're on the air. Thanks for calling.
Oh, thank you for taking my call. I just want to say, first of all, that this is my first year voting, and my family has been listening to you for a long time. So we want to thank you for just what you've been doing on the air for all these years.
Well, thank you, brother. We got 40% of people like you that don't ever vote, and that's who Trump's counting on to go out and get registered and to vote. This is a populist insurrection taking over the Republican Party, and it's why both the political parties are crapping their pants.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. But I had an article that I was looking at this morning, and I saw it said, I guess Wolf Blitzer was interviewing Obama. I don't know if you've seen it before. And he said that he wasn't going to leave office if Donald Trump actually did get elected. So, and then
I have not seen that interview. I have seen him say that Obama say that Trump is disqualified and Trump can't be president. I've seen Obama say he doesn't want to leave office, but he has to. I've seen him make a lot of draconian statements about basically if he could act like a dictator, he could get more done. Similar things to what Bush said But can you give me the headline on that? Because, boy, I'd like to see that. He told Wolf Blitzer that he won't leave office if Obama's elect, if Trump's elected.
Yeah, he said it's actually the Burrard Street Journal. It says President Obama confirms he will refuse to leave office if Trump is elected. And it actually says in the article that he was prepared to use full force, you know, the Secret Service. He's instructed the Secret Service to use full force in defending the White House from the Trump family. And, of course, Trump responded with he's...
Okay, let me guess. You were reading a transcript?
I just went to this website, yeah, and started reading the...
Yeah, there's a lot of... I don't know about the website you're mentioning, sir, but if that was said, my phone would be ringing off the hook within seconds. I'd have people beating down my door within 20 minutes. I'd be on air no matter what time it was, at 3 p.m. or 3 a.m. or Christmas morning, okay, or New Year's evening. Sir, that is absolutely not true. When you see transcripts out there claiming that Wolf Blitzer interviewed Obama and he said that he was not going to leave office, that would be sensational. That would be impossible because he wouldn't say it like that. They'd stage a false flag or launch a war or a depression like Roosevelt basically used a war to stay in power for a third term, was starting his fourth term. Here's another thing. There was this army document circulating the web, supposed army document, saying martial law had already been declared months ago. Well, they're not going to call it martial law. They're going to call it a civil emergency. So there on its face, you know it's fake. And then the way it's written, we know it's fake, just like the fake Hillary records that were out there. But yeah, you got to really watch stuff like that. Send me a copy of that email, Austin. I appreciate your call. And I've had them do this to me as well. They will say that I said that we were going to have martial law last year because of Jade Helm. Never said it. I said it was training to acclimate the police, the military, and the public for troops on the streets. That's a fact that the Pentagon has been directed to do that and is bucking. I am going to go to your phone calls on whatever subject you want to raise. Obviously, the so-called military commander-in-chief forum last night was a debacle. You had Matt Lauer, who works for the Global Clinton Initiative at a high level, is paid by them, not disclosing that he was there basically refereeing with his boss. It wasn't a debate. There were a few good questions, and Hillary has a big fat earpiece in her ear. You've got her vomiting up weird green chunklets that do not look like cough drops with weird brown fluid. She can't give press conferences because she starts hacking. She has staged press conferences with 7 or 8 confidant members of the press. That's not a press conference. She's in the WikiLeaks, wants Parkinson's medication. And we've got Uma Abedin, her confidant, saying, do you have your earpiece? Do I need to bring your earpiece? In the WikiLeaks. So we have massive WikiLeaks news coming out next week. Julian Assange says, what will these rats do? I don't think they're invincible, but the media is going ahead with the image and the idea that they are and that nothing can stop them. So what do you expect them to do? Well, I expect them to continue to target the low information voters out there. I'm going to play these clips later, but Bill Clinton's slogan was a ripoff of Ronald Reagan. And as much as I like Donald Trump, I don't know how he copyrights Make America Great Again, because that's what Ronald Reagan always said word for word, and then that was ripped off by Bill Clinton, and then it's been, again, adopted by Donald Trump when it's politically incorrect. So it shows how we have Bill Clinton saying, make America great again, build a wall, deport felons, blah, blah, blah. Then Trump says it word for word, which was just standard U.S. policy 20 years ago, 15 years ago, and it's like he's a one-eyed, one-horned, flying purple people eater. They're scared of him because he's got General Flynn and other patriots that know the globalists are running al-Qaeda, that know that our leadership is selling us out to orthodox radical Islam, and that want to actually have decent trade deals that no one will be able to say no to because they're going to be fair. They still want this market. These are one-sided deals with globalists to screw us and the Chinese workers and the Mexican workers and the Indian workers. They sold globalism 60 years ago that you would actually have high wages in the third world and you would develop projects that worked in conjunction. In fact, since I mentioned it before I go to your calls, let's play a few clips of Bill Clinton in 91, 92, 93, saying, it's time to make America great again. Here he is. Now he says, of course, that Donald Trump and make America great, that means none of you that weren't here. He's saying you're not great. He's saying make it white. He's saying, yeah, that's right, that's right. No, globalism is screwing us over. The country's falling apart. We don't like it. We don't like China with a 40% on average currency tariff, where their currency's so low, there's no way we can compete. Then they have no environmental standards. Then they have power 3 to 4 times cheaper than ours because our government put regulations in to shut down our power plants. We are a wet blanket has been thrown on our economy if it was a fire. Trump wants to take the blanket off, put some kindling on, and we can start roasting marshmallows and hot dogs again, ladies and gentlemen. You just need to take the bowling ball, the ball and chain off our ankle, and then we can compete again. This is economic warfare in their own words. Look at everything they do, but they admit it's warfare.
So here's Bill Clinton back when he wanted to hoodwink people that he was really Ronald Reagan. I'm a Democrat. I like Reagan. Here it is.
I believe that together we can make America great again.
I want to attack these problems and make America great again.
To secure a better future for your children and your grandchildren and to make America great again.
Okay, so should I play Hillary saying build a wall, build a barrier, and deport criminals? Oh, you know what? I don't even need to. She said it. But see, her servile supporters that are few and far between, they don't care. They like the imagination that they're part of this big power structure. Okay, let's go to Gene in New Mexico, the home of Gary Johnson, or what is Aleppo? What is Aleppo for $200? Gene in New Mexico, you're on the air.
Hi, Alex. Well, you know, I'm an independent and every friend of mine is a libertarian. And it's interesting. None of them are going to vote for Gary Johnson. We think that the polls have rigged it to make it seem like he's doing pretty well, at, what, 7% or so? I cannot find a libertarian that's voting for him. But anyways, I wanted to tell you, I work in the medical field and all my coworkers were listening to your transmission right now. And what the big question is for us is, how long has Hillary been using that earpiece? Did she use it during the primaries or before?
Now, that's a really, really, really great question. Look, all I know is she's wearing an earpiece, and she hasn't responded yet. I was searching earlier for Hillary's response to earpiece controversy, and the silence is deafening. I mean, I'm sure as soon as she does respond, one of our reporters will come in there and tell me, or Drudge Report will have it up. But that's a big question. When will she respond to the earpiece situation? That's a big question. What do you think?
Well, I think my coworkers and I, we think that the liberal media is going to spin it and say that this is a hearing aid or that it's cotton balls, which is not, okay? It's not. We looked at the footage. That's not a hearing aid, and that's not cotton balls. Okay, so that's basically it. So, yeah, we want to know how long has it been doing done.
I hear you, ma'am. God bless you. And they are moving on every front right now. Looking at DrudgeReport.com, these stories are also up on Infowars.com, but they're easier to find at DrudgeReport.com on the left-hand side. Battle for the Internet. UN takes over October 1st. FCC Commissioner warns Dems are gunning for conservatives. They've said they want the Federal Elections Commission and the Federal Communications Commission to come after alternative independent media, and they name Matt Drudge as the lead elephant. Now Hillary says, get Breitbart, that it has no right to exist. She says, I have a dark heart and need to be dealt with. So we have the Federal Elections Commission. Commissioner warns Dems are gunning for conservative media. So does the head of the FCC. To the FCC head's credit, he's saying, hey, a bunch of my colleagues want to shut down free speech. You better watch out. And now they claim they have the UN and these treaties we've signed where the EU can sue American websites or American individuals. In fact, it's already happening. Cases are being lost in Europe against U.S. companies saying you can't link to someone's website unless they have approval. And Playboy, a so-called American company, has gone to Europe and actually won the suit saying you can't link to our articles. What? That's what gives you the traffic. That's what creates the internet. That's what creates connectivity. No, they want censored channels where you can only go to certain major mega sites. That's always been the plan. The globalists want to turn the internet into a glorified cable box. Isn't that just cute? So it's getting worse and worse and worse by the minute. They're coming for the internet. And the communist Chinese have met with Zuckerberg, the head of Facebook, the heads of Google. They've met with everybody. And they've lined up how to censor globally. And the only country saying it's not going to censor that has any real power is Russia. And again, I'm not here trying to just say, oh, look, Russia does the right thing again. Russia does the right thing again, banning GMO crops, saying their national initiative is to promote organics worldwide and to ban glyphosates. I mean, just everything that I would personally do that's common sense, that's pro-human, Russia is doing it. And it's shameful that the so-called land of the free, home of the brave, has been infested by every form of totalitarian criminal you can imagine globally, and that we've now been turned into an engine of worldwide tyranny. Let's go ahead and go back to the phone calls. Let's go ahead and talk to George in Connecticut. You're on the air, George.
Hi, Alex. I'm wondering if we could use this earpiece and make a major issue of it and say, is Hillary now the first Manchurian candidate? She's spacing out. Maybe they'll put electrodes in her, do the El Cid routine, and even when she's in comatose, they'll just have her mouth move and we'll have a speaker speaking out whatever they want, and Mr. Kane will spew out his liberation communist theology as an addendum.
That's a good point. Glenn Kessler, who is a spokesperson for Hillary, says that there was no earpiece. Well, we expect to see more than just that from known liars. I mean, Hillary Clinton is a known liar. What do you think?
Well, I mean, all we have to do is look at her past history. She changes her view whenever the wind changes. So how can she have any truth in her?
Well, I think it's a really good question, and some of the other callers are raising it. What happens if she dies in office? And then we've got this Kane character, but let's go past that. You just mentioned that. I can make a lot of joke videos here about now we know why she's barking like a dog and acting all crazy and doing weird stuff. Because, you know, maybe people are playing jokes on her via the earpiece, telling her to bark like a dog, shit, roll over. But seriously, what type of person has to be told by some shadowy guy with a tranquilizer pen, it's okay, you're okay, keep talking, and then suddenly she looks like she has confidence and everything's okay? I've got to be honest with you. It hit me this morning that it's like she's under mind control. In fact, Hillary acts like someone under MKUltra mind control. I'm serious. I mean, doesn't she?
Yes, she does. I mean, I truly think she's part of a Manchurian candidate program.
George, stay there, because you raised this, and I was going to raise it. I'm going to come back to you. So stay with us, folks. A lot of other callers, and obviously a bunch of big guests today. Stay with us. By the way, Nico ran in because I said, hey, keep checking. See if somebody's responded from the Hillary camp about the earpiece. This is big news, one of the top stories in the world. Top of DrudgeReport.com, all over the place. An InfoWars.com story. Paul Joseph Watson wrote it. And, of course, we've got James Woods, along with many other Americans, pointing out that the WikiLeaks have the actual emails where Uma Abedin, her handler, her groom of the stool, you could say, I mean, stays in the same room with her. That was the position of the groom of the stool and the Queen of England, was they stayed in the same room, helped you get dressed, wiped your butt. I mean, I think it's fair to say in the type of illnesses that Hillary has, that does Uma Abedin wipe her butt? I mean, I'm being serious. Does she change her diapers? Well, we know she brings her the earpiece. So we have the smoking gun, thanks to the investigative skills of James Woods and others. And so now we ask the question, what are our spokespersons saying? And Nico came in and he said, listen, Glenn Kessler is the Washington Post writer responding to Hillary Clinton spokesman John Schweizner. I don't even know how to say it. There's, quote, no earpiece. There was no earpiece. But in a way, the Washington Post is already a mouthpiece of Hillary. That's why they were given the quote. show, one mouthpiece told another mouthpiece that then vomited on us, that's Glenn Kessler, the statement of Hillary Clinton, without even showing us a photo of why the public is so upset. So even when I'm wrong, I'm right, because these people are minions of Herr Hillary. But going back to George, we know that mind control is a real thing. It's been declassified. Thousands of U.S. school children were kidnapped. So were Canadians. So were British and others. A part of MKUltra, MK Naomi alone. That was declassified in the 70s. There's a lot of other more advanced projects going on. And if you expand on that, they were able to electroshock them, put them on drugs, and program them to have new identities. Now, that's primitive mind control. They've got microchips that can have total control. They've got drugs, social conditioning. But a lot of times you'll have multiple personalities. And sometimes when the mind control wears off, especially when you get older, you start going into catatonic fits. You start going into other personalities. You start going into psycho jerk, joker personalities. You start going into little kid personalities. And that's why you'll see Hillary acting like a little kid with balloons falling, or acting all dizzy and insane like she's having a seizure, or acting all scared and freaked out when somebody asks her a question and a guy jumps up with a tranquilizer pen and says, it's okay, keep talking, and she snaps back into it. Mind control is basically making someone artificially mentally ill so you can then direct and control them, drug them, and then have them take the blame for something. That's the most common. There's many different forms of it. But normal mental illness and psychological collapse also looks like mind control. So she's either on a bunch of drugs, mentally ill, or under mind control. And I think it's pretty much all three of those. I mean, she's surrounded by all these doctors, by all these people. She's clearly on a bunch of different drugs. She's clearly got health problems. So I think it's a cornucopia of those. But now Fox News is reporting, buzz about a bud. Clinton camp denies claim she wore earpiece at forum. So now the responses are coming in as we speak. So they've been forced to respond yet again. But George, seriously, what made you think she acts like she's under mind control?
Well, I had a couple things. I mean, she had that brain surgery. I was thinking they could have put a chip in her head. They've done that with monkeys and various other things to keep them going even when they're ill. And she like some of the things you just mentioned, but also it seems like she's under control, and also her husband has been questioned whether he was under mind control or some sort of MK Ultra situation. There's been various videos on the web, so I was wondering if they put him under, and she's also part of the same programs, why wouldn't they have tried to do something like that for her, especially if she's getting ill? And she may be the first transhumanist person where they may be wiring her up to just be a human robot.
You're right. In fact, she acts like the first bionic woman, but instead of her being like the $6 million man in Steve Austin, she's just basically a reanimated corpse, barely kept alive, stumbling around, repeating what she's told. And I hate to say that, but that's what it looks like. Now, this is satirical right now, but here's a video of her coughing up these little green turds or whatever. And I put some audio behind it because these are actually little Martian babies. Here it is.
Our mother is giving birth to our this planet will serve us well. Oh, yeah. No, not the Trump. Not him, the enemy. Oh, yeah. Mommy, everyone is here. The planet is ours. Oh, yeah.
Well, what do you think about Hillary with the email scandal with the DNC, how they stole it from Bernie?
Disturbing.
Is that a man taken over by those creatures? I think we're onto something here.
The Empire's on the run.
So, Donald Trump Jr. retweets Paul Joseph Watson's article, top story on Drudge, now one of the top stories in the country. Fox News, CNN, they're all starting to cover it. The Washington Post, a mouthpiece of the Clintons, had basically Josh Schwartzrin, the official spokesman for Hillary, vomit some green globlets into his mouth and tell us that there was no earpiece. And the reason I'm obsessing on the bizarre green goblets and brown fluid coming out of Hillary's mouth during her coughing fit Monday, one of many coughing fits this week, is that imagine if Vladimir Putin couldn't talk without coughing, was stumbling around, acting like a five-year-old, looked like he was having seizures, and was vomiting green globulates out. I mean, when he goes on vacation for a week every time, they say he's dead. Imagine if Donald Trump was vomiting green globulates out. It would be the top story. Remember the head of the Democratic Party who was running against Obama, and he was actually ahead at first, Howard Dean. But the system didn't want him in there early on, and so he had a corduroid, microphone.
Cardioid
that only works right up against your face. So when a rock band's around you beating on the drums and, you know, the guitars and the amplifiers, you only hear what's right around it. That's how singers are able to be in the middle of a maelstrom of sound, of deafening, eardrum piercing, blood curdling decibels. And you're able to just hear the scream there. Well, if everybody else is screaming around you, but you tune that out and only isolate like the party did to him on TV, him screaming the roar, that destroyed him because the media decided to make it all about how he's a loon. They decided to use that against Howard Dean, and it worked. Vomiting up green globulates and brown fluid in the middle of a hacking attack with her lips all pursed like she was the queen of the slurm from a Futurama episode, spilling out poison to her minions. I mean, this is sensational. So I want to make it into a little GIF if we can. And I think we should start having her vomit out lies as well into the cup with the little slurm creatures. I think this is absolutely essential because this is how you get to the low information voter that doesn't even know what planet they're on. Is something like this. You know, you ask her, has she been invaded by parasites like in the movie The Creeps? Does she have brain parasites that cats can give you? She could be vomiting up actually an amoeba infection out of her sinus that's draining and that she's vomiting out poisonous amoebas. Now, it doesn't matter that that's not true. This is what the low information people want. Let's give them what they want. Let's give them the fact that Hillary is actually a space alien filled with giant amoebas and that they're now gestating and that she's now giving birth to them. I'm going to go back to your calls, but I played this satire piece that we shot last night before our live coverage of the forum. And by the way, hundreds of thousands of people tune in on YouTube alone, hundreds of thousands here, hundreds of thousands on TV stations. I would say millions counting radio stations that picked it up last night. We had 2 hours of coverage, you know, the 1 hour of the event, an hour after that. Some people complained and said they talked over 90% of it. That's how we're able to carry it. We started this 4 years ago in the last election. People checked it legally. So now the Young Turks and Glenn Beck and everybody else copy us, which is fine. Because we take State of the Unions, we take debates that are media events, and then we analyze the media and analyze the propaganda, which is our fair use free speech right. We couldn't do this with a football game or a boxing match because that's entertainment. But when it's public forum and something like this, especially if NBC has taken taxpayer money, which they have, I've checked with lawyers, they can't stop us. I mean, they could try to, but the point is that we're analyzing their globalist enemy transmission BS in real time. I saw a few complaints going, man, all you do is read, the transcript that's live on screen, the closed captioning, and we can't hear what they're saying. If you want that, you tune in to MSNBC. If you're like me, you have a computer on with our feed, and then I have the TV on with MSNBC, and I just tuned up and down, back and forth. See, I want different selections, different. We change things. We trailblaze. We do new things. I'm not saying I have all the answers, just we do new things. And so that's what we do there. I know in the troll community, it's fun to bitch about everything. But the point is, we came up here and did a live analysis. I think the crew did a great job. We get better each time. of breaking down the lies in real time. So we're kind of like the truth casting. They have the closed captioning and they have the globalist disinfo casting with Hillary. We're there to give the people's live breakdown of collaborator enemy globalist media with Matt Lauer of the Clinton Foundation hosting it. I have no respect for these debates because they're not real debates. They're always geared against the populist candidate. And so that's why we're doing this to great effect. But before I go any further and back to your phone calls and a bunch of clips and a ton of news I haven't hit yet, let's play my little satire piece that's powerful on radio, but more powerful on TV. So if you're a radio listener, go to Infowars.com/show, and you'll be able to actually see what I'm talking about when we show the Exorcist clip and the Kim Jong Il clip and the Creeps clip, because these are all movies where someone is possessed by something on the inside and green slime and cockroaches come out. And so archetypally, Hillary vomiting up what looks like green turds. I mean, they're not lozenges. I don't know what they are. I don't know how she was talking with big lozenges in the back of her throat before. I mean, this woman is a wreck. And the point is, she looks like hell. She has low energy. She's a tyrant. She says she wants to shut down the independent new free press. They're openly coming after all of us. And so, if the general public wants to get down in the green slime and the green muck here, I'm telling the Liberty Movement, if we take this little clip of her vomiting these globulates out and cut to her looking at the cameras having a hallucination, and cut to her looking at the balloons like a loon, and cut to her looking like the Joker cackling like a hyena, and just mix all that together, this is the essence of this goblin creature. If I went to have coffee, say, once a week with a friend, and they started acting and looking like Hillary Clinton, I'd say they were demon-possessed, and I wouldn't get around her. So Drudge has a poll going right now. We can put it on screen. Did Hillary have an earpiece, or did she not have an earpiece? And the votes just started on his Twitter feed. So wearing an earpiece or not wearing an earpiece? I say wearing an earpiece. So let's do Alex Jones's vote right now here on TV. But that part doesn't even matter. What we know is this woman is propped up by a facade, and WikiLeaks and all the evidence absolutely shows that in a big, big way. But here is my satire piece.
Ladies and gentlemen, there's been a lot of conspiracy theories about Hillary Clinton's health. Yeah, she was in the hospital for a year having brain surgeries, and she can hardly walk and is always falling down. It looks like she's having seizures. And yeah, WikiLeaks admits that she was trying to get Parkinson's medication. But let's forget all that. The fact is, she's out there giving speeches every day and has to cancel them, having these coughing fits that are associated with different arrhythmias and heart problems. But listen, it doesn't matter to me. She proved just a few days ago in Cleveland that she is incredibly healthy. When what goes in must come out, like out of the movie Creeps. It goes in your mouth, it comes out of your mouth.
Inside you.
And get in through your mouth, and you walk around while they incubate.
It was like Linda Blair and the Exorcist spewing green pea vomit on the priest. Or maybe it was more like a film made a little bit later, just a few years ago, Team America, when Kim Jong Il is finally killed. We learned he was just a puppet.
Look. Of a cockroach creature. Uma Abedin climbs out of the mouth.
You have not heard the wrath of Kim Jong Il. I will return. You shall see. I will be back. No wrong offerings.
We'll be here waiting for you, Kim Jong Il.
For a more advanced species that actually escaped from the stars. So whatever's happening, though, clearly Hillary has entered that genre of the Creeps or Team America or, yes, the Exorcist. Because when it comes to overthrowing countries and killing hundreds of thousands of Christians, Linda Blair ain't got jack crap on Hillary Rodham Clinton. I'm Alex Jones for Infowars.com.
Our mother is giving birth to our this platypus that as well. Oh, yeah.
That's inside Hillary Clinton's bedroom with Uma Abedin. Paluma overseeing an operation.
Yes.
She's giving birth.
The planet is ours. Oh, yes.
Well, what do you think about Hillary with the email scandal with the DNC, how they stole it from Bernie?
Disturbing.
That's a Hillary supporter right there. All right, that video is satirical. Obviously, just so media matters, everybody knows. We don't believe Hillary's actually vomiting up little green space aliens. But you will say we said that. And then folks will come visit InfoWars and find out we never said that. And then you'll be discredited further. Oh, and just like you said, there's no pickle pop when you open a can of pickles or a jar of pickles. And then, of course, when Wolf Blitzer went on TV to open the canister, it popped. And they went, okay, it did pop. Okay, Hillary's full of bull. Who opened the pickle jar for? The point was, you acted like she was Samson. You acted like that, you know, she was the archetypal Greek god of strength and honor. Or I guess the demigod, the half god Hercules and his seven feats, his 12 wonders. Hillary Clinton will now take on the top UFC fighter, heavyweight champion, and win. Hillary doesn't have earpieces. Hillary can open all the pickle jars, even though she rarely gives press conferences and is rarely seen and has to stumble around while having seizures. Before I go any further, we need to fund this operation, and we sell the highest quality non-GMO heirloom open pollinated seeds. Everybody should have seeds. Everybody going into this global depression, in my view, should be prepared. We have 20% off on Survival Shield Nascent Iodine X2. We have massive discounts of 30 to 40% off. Biggest discounts we're ever able to offer on high quality storable foods at InfoWarsStore.com. These are the freshest, highest quality, at the lowest prices you're going to find. And by that, we do a nexus with high quality, low price. You can obviously find even more gourmet, delicious stuff out there that costs three, four, five times. But this is what I've chosen for my family. They've been around 8 years, and they're already one of the top three companies out of hundreds because of their service. It's My Patriot Supply. We carry their entire spectrum of food. It's drop shipped from them. Their entire line is on InfoWarsStore.com. Right next to InfoWars Select, that is the exact same food, same packaging, but I'm able to get lower prices because I did a private labeling deal with them. And how did that happen? I said, I want to be competitive. I want to dominate the market. I need to get a lot of money to fund our operation. I need to get people prepared with high-quality food. If they've been a sponsor for 3 years. I said, I'm walking, because there's a couple other good companies out there, not as good as you, but close. I'm walking if I can't get an even lower price. And that's just what I do. And they said, okay, we can get around the contracts with private labeling. Bada beam, bada boom. You will find the lowest price on InfoWars Select, even lower than My Patriot, up to 10% on average. Because they have some specials sometimes too. With InfoWars Select, their entire spectrum. But when I'm able to do these specials of 30 to 40% off, no one can get even close. This is the best deal in the industry. And with all the insanity and all the inflation and all the craziness, let's hope we never need this food. Let's hope we're wrong or we expose this and people wake up. It never happens. This is insurance. You don't lose. You can eat. Total win. Undoubtedly, food prices have been going up for years. They're going to go up higher. So you freeze the cost now and into the future can do amazing things. Because a lot of this stuff is, I want to call it gourmet. A lot of it's near gourmet. I mean, some of it really is incredibly delicious. A lot of it's just basic stuff. It's a wide spectrum. They have a lot of specialty deals as well. And they have some more expensive, more gourmet lines. But all of it's available at InfoWarsStore.com. InfoWarsLife.com is the subsection where you get all the nutraceuticals, all the different supplements. Folks, if you're not taking BioTrue Selenium, that's key in electrochemical activity, you're insane. If you're not taking Brain Force, you're crazy. If you're not taking Supermel Vitality, I think you're nuts. If you're not taking Secret 12, these are all game changers. Game changers. DNA Force is totally insane what it does for the price. Other competitors that have similar formulas are $500 to $600. They are raping you with sevenfold markups. We bring you nutraceutical stuff that most people get from a doctor. People won't buy this at a vitamin store at the cost. So people, doctors sell it. Because people go, oh, it's a doctor. It must be worth it. Just the BioPQQ in this bottle cost us $40. Now, we've got products that are $9.95 that are super high quality. But with DNA Force, you're talking about a product for $134 that's got $70, $80 worth of product in it. Yeah, there's 100% markup there, too. Not a sevenfold. BioPQQ, the real, true, absorbable biotype from biology, not chemical, not synthetic. They're the only one, the Japanese own it, folks. We buy it from Mitsubishi America. This stuff is nutraceutical. That's only one ingredient in this baby. This is the flagship DNA Force. InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. Deep research, patented ingredients, difficult to source. This is one of our products that we can that has hundreds and hundreds of certified studies. This is one of the only products where even the FDA lets you make claims, but we don't do it. Go research BioPQQ for yourself. And while the Japanese for 25 years worship it, okay? Because it is the real deal. Bio, I noticed that I was over at one of my cousin's houses that's really into health and nutraceuticals, and I noticed they had a $55 bottle of BioPQQ, but it wasn't BioPQQ, it was PQQ, and it was a synthetic type that I happened to know cost that company $5 to put in that bottle, and you just don't absorb it. Your cells don't know what it is. Understand that. That's the type of stuff they do. $50-something dollars a bottle for just one ingredient we've got in this in DNA Force. I'm going to come back to your calls. Sorry. Vanessa Souza's coming up in a couple of segments from now. I'm going to go right back to your phone calls here in a moment. Scottish John and Rick in Canada and Ray in Illinois and Joe in Illinois and Brandon in California. I'm going to try to bam, 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 get to everybody quick. Briefly, though, I mentioned this, but just look at this headline out of the Hill. Clinton campaign warns media to tread carefully when talking about her health. And then we see all these reporters getting fired for bringing it up, like Dr. Drew. This is how the mafia operates. This is outrageous. So I love making fun of Hillary Clinton. It's my right as an American. My ancestors fought so I wouldn't live in North Korea. So I wouldn't live in a country overrun by thugs. And whatever's wrong with Hillary Clinton, her expiration date is up. I don't wish any harm against her. I'm just pointing out that I told you, I mean, Donald Trump rushes into a goblin's nest. He's battling goblins. He may get some goblin guts, goblin blood on him, metaphorically. But as long as we don't catch him kissing a goblin, and then the goblins vomit, and then we catch him in bed with a goblin, as long as we don't have problems like that, there's not an issue. And the media then writes articles that I actually believe Hillary's a goblin and that Trump's battling goblins and I'm insane. No, it's called an allegory. It's called satire. And that's why we're the king of the memes on the internet now, because folks have fun with this. We got to have fun with this. Now she's vomiting goblin babies out of her. I mean, you know, at a certain point, there's got to be a South Park episode about what is secretly living inside Hillary Clinton. Let's go ahead and take a call here. Let's go ahead and talk to Joe in Illinois. Joe in Illinois, you're on the air.
Yeah, thank you. Your crew, for all the info that you give us, I think the InfoWars are, of course, have been set. But anyways, what I was saying is, why wasn't Hillary's stance on bringing thousands of refugees to the United States to the forefront on that Commander-in-Chief forum? Because to me, I think that's the most dangerous threat to our national security that jeopardizes the American safety, the lives, the sovereignty.
No, I agree. What are we bringing unvetted refugees here? Because they'll attack Trump for saying no to that. His people then believe, oh, he's really weak on that. No, Hillary attacks him on whatever he's strong on, hoping he quits doing it because it's so damning. That's why Media Matters takes what we cover and do and acts like it's so discrediting, hoping Republicans look at that and go, oh, look, they told us not to do what Alex Jones is saying, You know, because they care about us. No, they don't want you getting the weapon systems in the information war that are so devastating. Thank you for the call, Joe. Scottish John in Texas, in the ATX. You're on the air, Scottish John.
Hey.
Hey.
How are you doing?
I'm all right. Worldwide broadcast. Just here battling the New World Order. How are you doing today?
I'm doing all right, man. Listen, before I get to the point I called in about, let me tell you right quick. I went down to San Antonio 2 weeks ago to sit my citizenship test. And a big security guard escorted me out of the building. Do you think it was a mistake for me to wear my Hillary for prison t-shirt?
Wow, so you went down to do what? I didn't get the whole story.
To take my citizenship test.
Okay, so you went out to take your citizenship test, and then you weren't allowed in the building with a Hillary for prison shirt. Wow, they violated your free speech? That would have been a big story if you got it on video.
I was joking about the t-shirt. I would love to have done it, but I don't think it would have been a wise thing to do. Do you?
Oh, I think when we're in a major global crisis and everything's melting down, the wise thing to do is the desperate move. And I don't think it's even desperate to wear a t-shirt. We need to get really aggressive and hardcore. Scottish John, go ahead.
Listen, you had a guest on last week. You introduced him as Margaret Thatcher's top scientific advisor, and you said, look him up. Well, I'd already looked this guy up, Alex, and if I can go back just over 2 years ago, you were kind enough to have me in as a guest talking about the Scottish referendum.
Now, yeah, we'll talk about it when we come back, Scottish John. We're back in 70 seconds. Stay with us. Gary Johnson is getting fawning media coverage, the likes of which no libertarian candidate has ever gotten, because he's got a horrible anti-gun, pro-globalist TPP platform, and he will help get Hillary elected. He's basically only taking votes, in my view, away from Donald Trump. But getting back to Scottish John, talking about, and I've known him at gun rallies for 20 years, lives here in Austin. He's now down there taking a citizenship test. That's great to hear. Scottish John, you were getting into the situation with the Scottish referendum. Go ahead.
Well, it's about his lordship's claims as being Thatcher's top scientific advisor about climate change. Now, the reason I want to talk about this, Alex, is because he was very disingenuous to me personally. The following week, he was a guest on your show. Now, if you remember, you had some illness in your family, a couple of your relatives, and Rob Dew hosted the show. Now, the first words out of his lordship's mouth were, some numpty called Scottish John says, if you vote yes to Scottish independence, this will mean there will be no such thing as a new world order. Well, I never said any such thing.
Okay, well, listen, I don't want to make this personal, okay, and always getting into old news and what Lord Monckton said or didn't say. Lord Monckton's a leading fighter against global carbon taxes and the rest of it. I actually saw the clip you're talking about. He was just hearing the caller or a clip he'd heard and you know, pointing out that it was an important referendum against the globalists. But, I mean, my mistake here is this. I don't screen phone calls, and sometimes it makes it really interesting. But other times, everybody's got these weird little agendas about stuff years ago and a Scottish referendum that failed to leave the UK and then just, you know, bones to pick with somebody else. And the last time you called in, and you're a nice guy, I've known you for 20 years on the street, it turned into a bunch of other side stuff. I just can't do it, okay? So from here on out, I always noticed we had better callers at night. I used to have a nighttime radio show. We have a lot of great callers. It's not saying you're all bad. But during the day, a lot of folks are off work. They're taking off. They're drinking a six-pack of beer. They're kind of calling in about whatever they want. And then I just say, oh, it's open phones, whatever you want to cover. And it's just stuff that I can't even hardly understand what you're talking about. And if I, the host, that am informed and involved and really listening to you, can't understand you, it must sound like garbled Martian to our listeners across the country and the world. Tens of millions of people listening that don't even live here in the United States. So I'm done. In fact, from this point forward, I'm going to do topic-based calls where I only open the phones up on one topic like everybody else does. From this day forward, September 8th, 2016, I am finale done. I cannot handle it. I cannot deal with it. Because we have some great callers calling today, but we had some other ones, man, where it is just over the top. It is over the top. Now, I bet Rick's a great caller. Let's talk about hack DNC and the Russians. I want to go to him. We'll see what happens. Rick, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Good day, Alex. How are you?
Good. Go ahead.
Who blew up the Reichstag?
I thought you were talking about hacked DNC and the Russians. Who blew up the Reichstag? The Nazis, most evidence shows, burned up their Capitol building in February 27th, 1933 to basically declare civil emergency, start arresting their political opposition, and make Adolf Hitler a dictator.
So it proves that they never do anything for a one-of. So who hacked the DNC?
Well, a lot of different people have gotten into the DNC, but what matters is they're not denying the documents are real and it's hurting them.
Oh, I know, but what they're going to try to do is, now it justifies them saying that it was the Russians.
I didn't understand that last point.
Well, now they're going to try to say that.
Well, they've been saying it's the Russians over and over again, so yeah. And Hillary's vomiting up green balls, and yeah, but no, I hear you, Rick. All right, we'll be back with Dinesh D'Souza, political prisoner. Straight ahead, I'm Alex Jones. Now, I've been interviewing Dinesh D'Souza off and on for about 10 years. I remember growing up being a fan of Ronald Reagan and, you know, seeing Dinesh D'Souza eloquently break down free market capitalism and the true Americana system on, like, Lair NewsHour. And so it's surreal to, you know, have him on with us today and to know that he's a political prisoner, has been a political prisoner. And I've seen people like the Young Turks attack him savagely, saying you have no right to criticize Hillary and her foundation and her servers and her lies because you were in prison for 9 months. Well, that's a badge of honor. It's like being not, you know, locked up in the Soviet Union, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, because he got a few of his friends to donate money to his college roommate who unsuccessfully ran for the Senate. I mean, that's nothing. Foreign dictators giving Hillary money. She's represented the Chinese communist president, the emails now show. I mean, that is espionage. That is high treason, folks. That is the death penalty. And I'm not calling for the execution of Hillary, who turned into a martyr. And I think God's cursing her right now. Look at her physically. But it really is surreal that she thinks she's too big to fail. And that she's connected to so many other people that are corrupt in government, both parties, that she thinks she's Teflon. All this has done, I think, is really discredit the entire government, the FBI, you name it. You have to roll her oranges instead of press conferences, and then she writes on them. I mean, it gets weirder and weirder. And then I was like, wow, I we had Dinesh D'Souza on a few weeks ago. Why is he on today? Because I didn't ask for him to be on. I'm glad he's here. And I said, no, he wanted to come on to basically talk about Hillary attacking you and misrepresenting what you said because of the danger of it. So I'm glad he's here to give us this breakdown as someone who is a hero. I mean, not so much as a, you know, speeding ticket until they throw him in jail because he had the second highest grossing documentary film in history and now has another one of the top five in history. And I love when he's on national news or on the Young Turks or other, they look and they go, nobody watches your films. You're nobody. You're nobody. You don't have a bunch of New York Times bestselling books. You know, aren't a success story for an immigrant that came here and ended up, heading up a whole agency for Reagan. No, you're a I love how they always tell me I'm a nobody, too. We don't reach 28, 30 million people a week. We're not exploding. We don't have the top story on Drudge right now. We don't. No. We're nobodies. But they do come after people. And they're now announcing they're going after the internet, Matt Drudge. They list Breitbart as not having a right to exist in an official Democratic Party Hillary Clinton signed newsletter. They have the head of the Federal Elections Commission that persecuted this man. That was the agency itself, not the head of it, saying, look out, they're coming after conservatives. They're coming after the media. Same thing as Supreme Court Justice told Matt Drudge a year ago that he came here to warn us about. So the point I'm getting at here is setting the table is that we are entering a totalitarian system. They are desperate, but we don't have to be scared of them taking over if we take action. I believe they're hardening. They're taking the velvet glove off the iron fist is a sign of weakness. Now, I've not been around as long as Dinesh D'Souza, and I haven't, you know, seen it from every level. So maybe he's going to correct me if I'm wrong, because I really respect him. But this is a critical time in U.S. history. I mean, do you think that breakdown, sir, in the last 3 minutes was accurate? Or what can you add about how serious the stakes are and how dangerous the climate is in the media, how sycophantic they are right now?
I think that we are reaching a point in which political gangsterism is becoming normalized in this country. I haven't seen this in America in 30 years. I mean, whatever you thought about Jimmy Carter, I think the whole country came to the correct conclusion that he was a nincompoop. But no one thought that he was trying to be America's Al Capone. We saw a kind of gangsterism with Obama, because here's a guy whose goals are ideological, but who's willing to bend the law when he sees fit. He'll twist the immigration law. He'll selectively enforce Obamacare. He'll ignore the Defense of Marriage Act. He doesn't like the work provisions of welfare reform, so he ignores and sidesteps those. But with Hillary, with the Clintons, you're talking about gangsterism taken to a new level. These are people who operate in a mafia mode. They put American foreign policy up for sale. They've set up this sort of transaction. It's almost a kind of systematic system. Step one is that Bill Clinton goes out to a potential donor. They pay him five times his normal fee, $750,000, to speak 15 minutes of pure rubbish. It's obviously not for the speech. It's a down payment, a kind of a bribe for Hillary to give up or change her position on some critical element of foreign policy. And so then she does it. She does what the donor wants. And then millions of dollars, this is step three, flow into the Clinton Foundation. And this happens again and again and again and again. Now, the press knows about this. They have seen the documentation. They know about it. But they very much want Hillary in the White House, and so they are ignoring it. They're not focusing on it. If this had been Trump, they'd be covering it every single day, and the outcry about it would be deafening.
Now, again, I'm honored to have you, and it's usually even hard to get you on the show because you're such a hardworking guy, making films, writing books, you know, traveling the country. But specifically, you told the producer, oh, I'd like to come on specifically about Hillary attacking the alt-right and Alex. Because this is serious. So I'd like to get your inside view as someone who is a true American former political prisoner, kind of like our Alexander Solzhenitsyn, on what you would basically advise us to do at this point.
Well, first of all, I think that this whole business about the fact that Trump is trying to reinvent conservatism, I think is complete nonsense. Trump is not trying to reinvent conservatism. I mean, I'm about as mainstream a conservative as they come. I was an acolyte of Bill Buckley in my Dartmouth days. I then worked in the Reagan White House. I've been at the major think tanks like the American Enterprise Institute, the Hoover Institution at Stanford. So I don't know how you get more mainstream in the conservative movement. Now, I'm a patriot. Trump is a patriot. He may call himself a nationalist, but it's a slender difference. I believe in technological free market capitalism. So does Trump. He's made his money the old-fashioned way. He built buildings. He earned it. Now, I may disagree with Trump on some minor issues, but I think what Trump is really trying to do is not remake conservatism so much as he's trying to remake the Republican Party. Now, the Republican Party is not even among its friends as the stupid party. These are people who are unbelievably good at losing elections. They are surrounded and encrusted by opportunistic consultants who cash in on all the money. For them, politics is a business. So
they're taking a fall for the Democrats.
In some ways, they're in bed with the Democrats. I don't want to blur the distinctions too much because the Democrats are the party of sort of exploitation and theft, and the Republicans historically have been the party of
crime. Sure, they're the leading edge, basically pimped and controlled. The Republicans are more like the minions.
Well, Republicans have, in a sense, surrendered to the Democrats. Look at the way, I mean, we have three branches of government. True, the Democrats control one, the presidency, but we control the other, which is the Congress. Now, you would think that the Congress, which is actually the most powerful arm of the government,
is
the legislature. Right. In a democracy, the people who make the laws are the most powerful, are supposed to be the most powerful. But our Congress, the Republicans, have gone into a kind of fetal position, inert mode, and they allow Obama to run amok, and they don't do anything about it.
Sure. So what do you make of her alt speech? Because I'm selfish. I want to know, what do you make of her coming out misrepresenting what I said, what others said, saying shut down Breitbart? I mean, this is getting creepy.
I think what Hillary is trying to do is go to the old playbook, which is to hit the Republicans and the right with the accusation of bigotry. By the way, I kind of anticipated this. And in the movie, in Hillary's America, the book and the movie, we turn the tables on this woman and we show, wait a minute, first of all, Trump has nothing to do with the Ku Klux Klan or white supremacists. You may find five toothless guys in a trailer and say they endorse Trump, but the truth of it is you are the party of bigotry.
Well, that was my next question, and that information is getting out. And I want to talk about the film. Still in theaters, like here in Austin, a huge success. Let's spend a few minutes on the film itself, because it seems like Hillary is in panic mode. You've already been thrown in prison by these people. Should I be concerned?
Well, the film has been re-released in 400 theaters. That by itself is very unusual. It's been re-released because the theaters feel that there's a demand for the film and that politics is heating up. And so the film is actually going to have a good second run in the theater.
Exactly. I wondered why it was top 10 in history for documentaries. And then now it's suddenly back in theaters.
Yeah. I mean, well, let's put these things a little bit in perspective. When you mentioned earlier, guys like Cenk at the Young Turks saying, the film is a flop. Dinesh is a flop. He has no followers. Well, the truth of it is now that we have totally eclipsed Michael Moore as the leading documentary filmmaker.
That's right. His films are now flops. Yours are all mega hits.
No, historically, he still is the big fish. I mean, if you made a list of the top 10 political documentaries of all time, he has five. But he's made 20 films. I have three, but I've made three films.
That's what I'm saying. Clearly now, he's the past, you're the future.
Well, his last film, which came out, I believe, about a year ago, made $1 in its entire theatrical run. We made more than that in our first weekend.
That's right. And your Skype cut out. How much did because I saw it in Variety that it was a flop and that yours was hugely successful. I think it was like number six or so overall all time. How much did his make?
So Michael Moore's film made $3.8 million in its entire theatrical run. We made $4 million in our first weekend. The film is currently over $13 million, and it will obviously do even better. And then it's going to do really well in DVD. The book is 7 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list.
And this is important for folks that are out there and already awake. You're like, yeah, why do I care? I know Hillary's evil. Your neighbor doesn't get it yet. They're starting to get it. And this is a culture war. And the fact that Christian films and conservative films and libertarian films and hardcore films that are made by people that have been persecuted are winning at the box office is an indicator that we're winning the culture war.
Yes, and people don't realize that it's important to see a film in the theater. That's a way to put fuel in our rocket to help the film get disseminated even more
on
widely.
On TV, on cable, on DVD, it decides everything.
It decides that even the DVD distribution, whether it's Walmart and Target and Sam's Club, all that is affected by how the film does in the box office. So don't wait for it to come out in DVD later. That's when you can circulate it to your...
He said that I say 9/11 is an inside job. No, what I said was the Saudi Arabians, the globalists, are basically funding radical jihad. They're letting these attacks take place. They're using that to take our rights. That was in the news at the time. They then translate that over that I'm saying George Bush had a plunger like Wile E. Coyote blowing the building up. Or I talk about Oklahoma City. Clearly the Clintons were involved, Elohim City, Southern Poverty Law Center. I interviewed the cops that were involved. It was in the newspaper. Lawsuits have been won. I mean, it's crazy. Then they say, I say nobody died at Sandy Hook. No, that's not what I said. I hosted debates where people talked about the fact that Anderson Cooper had a blue screen and all this other craziness. But the point is, she then says, I have this dark heart and such a horrible person. And then she goes on to indict the, quote, new right, basically saying, shut it down. Here's a clip.
For a second
of Hillary Clinton.
It's also what happens when you listen to the radio host Alex Jones, who claims that 9/11 and the Oklahoma City bombings were inside jobs. He even said, and this really just is so disgusting, he even said the victims of the Sandy Hook massacre were child actors and no one was actually killed there. I don't know what happens in somebody's mind or how dark their heart must be to say things like that. But Trump doesn't challenge these lies. He actually went on Jones's show and said, your reputation is amazing. I will not let you down. This from the man who wants to be president of the United States.
Now, expanding on this, they also have this new thing that was saying for 4 years, but it's back in the news, that I say that the tornado 4 years ago that hit Oklahoma City was sent by Obama. A caller called and said, I think it's weather weapons. I think they did it. And I said, no, I think it's a real tornado. But there have been some weather weapons used in Vietnam and stuff. What about this new level, Dinesh D'Souza, of lying where they misrepresent what we say or what we do? I mean, I have MSNBC saying, quote, Alex Jones doesn't like Obamacare because he's deeply racist. But then they don't show where I say something racist. It seems like there's a new level of lying. We have Hillary saying that Trump shouldn't criticize the Federal Reserve. It should be off limits. Another quote. Clinton campaign warns media, tread carefully on health. The Hill. I mean, the way she lectures everyone, like she's already a dictator. What do you make of the lying and the dictatorial nature, Dinesh D'Souza?
Well, 4 years ago, when I made the movie on Obama, attacks on me, vituperative attacks, began to appear unsigned, but they were on a website called BarackObama.com. And I took this as an incredible compliment to be attacked directly and by name by the thin-skinned narcissist who's currently in the White House. So for you, Alex, I think this is a sign that you've arrived. When you have the Democratic presidential candidate attacking you by name, you got to think that your mom never expected that when you were a kid. So you've reached a certain status now, and it means that you're a threat. Look, I think Trump is a threat. And the reason that they're scared of Trump is he doesn't play by the old rules. What other Republican would have gone to the inner city and challenged the Democrats for the black vote? What other Republican would have talked about urban plantations, pointed the finger at Hillary?
He's literally reading right from your historical script. I mean, I'm sure you're honored as well.
He totally is, and there's a lot more there. So I actually hope that this guy will take DVDs of this film and send them to swing voters around the country.
That's a great idea.
5 million swing voters in 9 states.
That's a great idea. I mean, if listeners got the DVD or if you did a deal with Trump at cost to just bomb the swing states with this film, it could turn the tide. What about him going to Louisiana when Clinton and Obama are going to Mexico? I mean, this guy is so presidential in my view. Because, look, I was a little trepid a year and a half ago supporting him. But, man, now I'm really behind him. He really is really amazing.
Well, the very fact that Trump has a certain kind of bravery that I have actually not seen in 30 years. Even Reagan was a little uncertain about taking on the inner city. Trump has done it full-fledged.
He does. So he has bravery.
You can expect the media attack on him to be unrelenting. And that's because he poses a threat to this whole system, this whole encrusted, corrupt system.
He's literally showing up saying, you're on a plantation. I promise that I will cut the taxes in your area. And a lot of folks can say, well, that's almost discriminatory. No, it's not. It's real affirmative action to say, you have been screwed over, we're going to have tax incentives, and I'm going to tell companies, come to your neighborhood and hire you. I mean, that is incredible. He's not saying, yeah, I'm going to give you a barely livable wage and run your life. He says, I'm going to really try to get off your back.
He's getting to what liberals have always called the root cause. You know, people, conservatives will talk about the cops and how cops have an impossible and difficult job, and they do. But the reason that they have a difficult job is because the urban plantations created and maintained by the Liberal Democratic Party, these plantations are because life in those places is unlivable. And so Trump has gone right at the heart of it. And that's where the moral indictment of the Democratic Party is the most forceful and the most telling, because there are resemblances between the old slave plantations and these new urban
plantations. And what about when he said, I'm going to model myself after Lincoln? That has got to make the Democrats, the true party of the Klan, pull their hair out when he talks about a new Reconstruction, which had its horrible problems. I mean, that has got to freak them out, Dinesh. Dinesh D'Souza, Skype is cut off for a moment. We'll see if it comes back here. We're going to get him back up in the near future. But absolutely, InfoWars arrived a long time ago. But the power structure is pulling its hair out. It's absolutely freaking out. And again, if you want to get technical, folks, my whole family, from the time of Texas independence, was Southern. I had a lot of family that was Southern from Virginia and stuff since the colonies, but I had a lot of family from New York on my mom's side that came down as Christian missionaries and helped start the Texas Revolution. I think Dinesh may be gone, but that's okay. We got a lot coming up after this segment. And so I had family, folks, that were high level, okay, you know, obviously in the Confederacy and stuff, but I can tell you, it was a fraud. It was wrong. We got conned into that war. The globalists won a new civil war. And we need to come together as Americans. And that's what's so beautiful about Donald Trump. Dinesh, we only got 2 minutes left. Your Skype's back. I'm really concerned about how Soros is going to strike back. Black Lives Matter, civil war. They've done it in other countries. How do you expect? I think Hillary's a cornered rat. I think the tide's turned against her. Tell me if I'm wrong. In 2 minutes, what do we expect them to do? What should we be bracing for, Dinesh D'Souza?
Well, I think with Hillary, she will pull out all the stops. The degree of viciousness of this campaign is likely to escalate. And the attacks on Trump, there will be nothing that is sacred, nothing that is taboo. Now, Trump, I think it's still Trump's election to lose, believe it or not, just like it was Romney's election to lose 4 years ago. I think the most important thing that Trump can do is to signal to the American people that he's an independent, he's an outsider, he speaks his mind, but he's not crazy. In other words, this is not an indictment of Trump. Reagan had to do the same thing in 1980. People said he's a cowboy, he'll blow up the world. Reagan had to say, come on, guys, I'm not going to do that. So it's important for Trump to do that. The second thing, which he's already doing, is taking the battle to Hillary. I think our film and book can be an asset in helping him to do that. So I wish that he gets even more behind it than he has already.
Hillary'sAmerica.com, back in theaters, 400 screens, DVDs soon. Take your friends, take your family. Yes, I know you're already awake. Yes, I know you may have already seen it. It doesn't matter. We've got to deprogram these people. And if you give a liberal a little bit of attention and actually show them what's happened, they will wake up in many cases. Dinesh, thanks for coming on. Anytime you want to come on.
Just a small correction. Hillary's America, the movie.com.
That's right. Hillary's America, the movie.com. I'm teleprompter free, so I mess up a lot. Hillary's America, the movie.com.
That's it.
Dinesh, please come back sooner. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, folks, we're going to go to break. This is an epic time to be alive. I keep using the word epic because it is epic. It's historic. It's big. It's massive. And films like this can turn the tide. Also, supporting this broadcast, sending out videos, sending out the articles, sending out the links, sending out the podcast. It's a war. Also, buying products at InfoWarsStore.com. The network's funded by sponsors, and our local stations are, so support them. We are mainly supported by the products we sell. We're selling Hillary for President shirts for $9.95, shipping including. That doesn't support us. That just gets the word out. But get your shirts. I'm going to have to stop the special next week, $9.95, but running it through the weekend and the middle of next week. The shirts are about to sell out. We've got the preparedness special, 30 to 40% off, the super high quality, fresh, 25-year shelf life, storable foods at InfoWarsStore.com. We have got 20% off Survival Shield Nation Iodine X Tube. We've got 20% off on the Vitamin Mineral Fusion Fruit Punch Multivitamin. We have got a lot of other stuff. You need this stuff. You need heirloom seeds. We got great selections at the lowest prices in many cases, or very competitive. I mean, it's a win-win. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. I don't get paid to have Tadesha Souza on and promote his film. I don't get money for that. I'm promoted because it's all information warfare. It's truth. Truth is our weapon. All right, we got the panel coming in to break down the speech, Trump clips, special reports, and a lot more. Stay with us. Leanne McAdoo coming in.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I am Leanne McAdoo, taking over the reins, joined by the white male, Owen Schroyer. And we are going to go over this commander-in-chief forum last night, as well as Hillary Clinton's press conference that she held today, which was, of course, tightly handled as per usual. So all of her softball questions lobbied to her by the obsequious press. Anthony Gucciardi is going to be coming up in the fourth hour as well. We'll kind of be holding over. We got a lot of clips that we want to get to here. So kind of just piggybacking on that video that we just watched, just coming in, the gun grabbing, the come and take it. She doubled down on that last night at the commander-in-chief forum. Gun control is going to be part of her fight against terrorism here on U.S. soil. She was talking about the necessity of an intelligence surge, just basically making the case that we need to be able to vet people coming in this country. She was kind of underscoring that there. And that's what people are saying, is we have to be able to vet these people coming in. And she just kind of agreed with that. And then, of course, saying that here at home, for goodness sakes, we have to finally pass a law prohibiting people on the terrorist watch list from being able to buy a gun in the U.S., which I'm pretty sure that already exists.
Well, so it's the problem reaction solution that the globalists love to run on this country. But isn't it funny how she talks about problems with how we're handling terrorism, or problems, all these problems in government? She's been in the government.
Right.
So how is she sitting here like, I'll be the one with the solutions, I'm the one to bring solutions, pointing out all these problems that exist in government, when she's the one that's been there?
Right. I'm going to be the one that's going to bring in hundreds of thousands of these refugees that we cannot vet, and just let the American public know that this is a new reality that we're going to be living in, that those attacks that we're starting to see happening multiple times every month, pretty much now in Europe and other places, that's going to be the reality here in the U.S. So this is what Hillary Clinton is promising us as president, that she's going to take care of it by taking away your guns so that you do not have the opportunity to protect yourself and your family. And meanwhile, we've already reported on the fact that the drug cartels are helping jihadis there in Mexico, helping them get across the border, as well as supplying them with weapons. They actually traced one of the weapons used in the Paris attack to Operation Fast and Furious. So, I mean, come on. It's a total joke, but she doesn't want us to be able to protect ourselves. Hillary Clinton is going to take care of us.
Well, I think Donald Trump was right when he said that Hillary Clinton will be the next Angela Merkel for America. And if you look at what has happened in the Merkel regime in Germany, you certainly don't want that to happen here in America, especially when you're talking about terrorism attacks. So Hillary Clinton is going to try to groom the American public into this sort of, I don't know, getting used to or terrorist attacks being passe, like, oh, you know, just expect this when I become president. How about no? How about we don't expect that? But that's what she wants. She wants to groom the public to be like, oh, this is just standard now. It's not Hillary's fault. This is just standard 21st century living. We're not buying that. No.
I destabilized the Middle East and caused all the mayhem there, but now you can trust me to fix it. I'm sorry I created the refugee crisis, but now we're going to go ahead and give the refugees a home. Aren't I a great person? How wonderful am I?
Yeah, and she's taken in dozens, I'm sure she's taken in dozens of all of these, you know, refugees and undocumented immigrants that she's wanting us to take care of. And she uses her personal security, I'm sure, to protect them. But, you know, I want to talk about something else you mentioned. Hillary doubling down last night on these narratives. She also doubled down on some of the lies that she's telling about the classified documents, whether she sent them or didn't send them or knowingly sent them or didn't knowingly sent them. If she forgot or didn't remember, you know, who knows?
She did not recall.
She does not recall. She does not know. Who knows what the hell is going on? But she now is being exposed on another lie. This is from the Washington Times. Clinton email compromised in hostile cyber attacks. Remember, last night Hillary Clinton said there was no evidence, no chance, nothing that could even be relevant to her email being hacked by a foreign hacker. But even the Washington Times has to report on it. The FBI's once secret report on former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton's email system reveals that messages sent to aides were compromised by foreign actors.
Right.
This is the FBI, an official statement. The FBI did find that hostile foreign actors gained access to the personal email accounts of individuals with whom Clinton was in regular contact, and in doing so, obtained emails sent or received by Clinton on her personal account. Bam! Caught her lying again.
Right. And we've seen from the emails that WikiLeaks has released that she was concerned that her devices had been hacked. They said, don't use anything. They actually told her to turn the system off for a little while, and maybe that would reset it. And we know Guccifer actually released emails from Sidney Blumenthal, and that was how it was first discovered that she had her own private email, her own private email server. But I love how she points out, you know, Matt, there's no evidence. Of course, anything's possible. I could have been hacked, but there's no evidence. There's also no evidence that Russia hacked into the DNC servers, but they're going to just take that and run with it. You know, there's no evidence of that. But I just love how she's constantly pushing out these conspiracy theories. But whenever it comes back to her, nothing is real. Just like with her her earpiece that she was wearing during last night's presidential forum. So obviously this is still at the top of Drudge, our article. Was Hillary wearing an earpiece during last night's presidential forum? And there you can see it's like this pearl device. And her campaign, they've come out and they've denied it, saying she was wearing that she was not wearing an earpiece. The Clinton spokesman, Nick Merrill, said that what is seen in the photo is merely a reflection of the TV lights or a flash. So nothing else on her face is reflecting the TV lights or the flash. So, you know, maybe she needs to wipe her ear out, like, with a cloth.
No, I'll tell you what. If the crew can go back to that last image that James Woods tweeted out, you can actually see that whatever is in her ear is rounded. Look at the light. Okay, they're talking about the reflection. That is clearly a reflection of a bulge that is rounding out from her ear. That is not a typical shape of an ear. I mean, we shouldn't have to get into the science and geometry of an ear and light reflections. She's got an earpiece in, okay? Right. This is ridiculous. Why are we even having this debate?
Right.
Why are you denying this? This is, the sky is green, grass is red. I mean, give me a break.
Right, and there's nothing else on her face that is shiny like this. Absolutely nothing else is reflecting the light like this. Someone tweeted out, you know, they should have just said it was a hearing aid. But they can't do that because that there was no hearing aid ever mentioned in her professional report that was put out by her doctors. You know, she doesn't use a hearing aid. Also, from WikiLeaks emails right there in 2009, Huma Abedin asked her, did you remember to bring your earpiece or should I get it? So obviously she's been using an earpiece, and it's not the first time. People have claimed that she was also using an earpiece during the Benghazi hearing. You know, I can't stand it how it's a constant reflection. Anything that happens, the media, rather than getting to the bottom of it, like with this press conference today, hey, Hillary, you know, there's a lot of reports that you were using an earpiece at the forum last night. Is that true? No. What does the press do when they have their one shining moment to talk to Hillary Clinton? They ask her, do you think that you're being treated unfairly because you're a woman? Or what about the recent polls that show Donald Trump is about 2 points ahead of you? I mean, who cares about the polls? It doesn't matter. They're not, you can't even rely on them. This is the one thing they think that the American people really want to know about. No, we want to know about the freaking earpiece. And are you cheating? Are you that much of a liar that you need help?
Well, we know about the earpiece. She had an earpiece in. That was quite obvious. But this was the most... This is like last night you had the most pathetic excuse for a presidential debate you could ever see. And now today you have the most pathetic excuse for a press conference, I guess, except for maybe, what was that, yesterday or 2 days ago when they're rolling oranges down the plane. I mean, this is all such a pathetic joke. But after she closed out her press conference, she talked for about 6 minutes and then she took like four questions, total softball questions. But then afterwards, a reporter from the Daily Mail asked her about her implying that she had a concussion, implying that she had memory loss. And that's what she reported to the FBI. And she just brushed that question aside. She just said, oh, read the reports. She didn't want to address that question.
Like, we read the reports, Hillary Clinton.
Right. And that's why we're asking you.
You use the excuse of your concussion like 57 times. I do not recall getting the training. I do not recall signing that. I cannot recall what the C means on these emails. I was married to the president of the United States. She was a New York senator and now the secretary of state, and she doesn't know what a classified marking looks like. And the simple fact is, even I would know if I'm emailing about a drone strike, where it's going to be, who it's going to be against, what time. That's classified. I mean, you don't even have to mark that with a C for me to know that I shouldn't be doing that on an unsecured server.
And we already knew that she sent those emails and either she didn't recall or didn't know, whatever it was. She sent the emails with the C. And James Comey in July said that it was possible that a hostile actor, a foreign actor, gained access to Clinton's personal email account. But still last night she comes out and said there was no evidence, no reason to think that that happened. So she is just bold-faced lie in front of bold-faced lie. The media tries to cover up. They have this pathetic excuse for a press conference, first on a plane rolling oranges, and then on a tarmac with about 15 to 20 reporters. And you know how this probably went down, Leanne. You know, Clinton's handlers send a text to their, you know, nice media members that they work with, and they say, hey, you want the Hillary press conference first in a year? Come on out. You know, we'll let you ask a question. And then they get their little hand-chosen puppets out there to ask the questions. And then what do you get? You get a less than 20-minute press conference where Hillary just gets lobbed softball questions and doesn't have to get into actual issues. And then when she is asked about why she couldn't recall things, she says to read the reports. Well, we did read the reports. That's why we're asking.
Right, exactly. And I'm thankful the Daily Mail is out there asking the tough questions. And then the fact that she walks away from the podium, doesn't she understand that now that becomes the story? That when you do get asked these tough questions and you don't have your earpiece in, you can't answer them and you're stumped? You know, and I thought that a lot of the veterans there last night asked her some really good questions, but she didn't get pressed on it any further. She just was able to say, I never sent classified emails, when indeed there is an email where she's telling one of her aides to remove the classified heading so that they can easily fax it over to her. Oh, just remove that heading. They just arbitrarily mark things willy-nilly classified. It's fine. I need you to send that over to me. I mean, totally ridiculous. And this is a woman who's trying to explain why she should be the commander-in-chief when clearly she put the national security of this country at risk. One person, you know, they can't prove it for certain, but the man that was beheaded there in Iran and killed because he was named in one of these emails that came out, and he was actually, they thought he was a spy. So there's one potential victim right there.
Well,
her
so negligence,
her recklessness, as James Comey called it.
There's so many different directions you can take, you know, everything that's happened with Hillary. The deleted emails, the lies about the emails, the media cover-ups, her health. I mean, there's all of this stuff. And it's so obvious to me that even Colin Kaepernick or Colin Kaepernick, Paperneck, whatever you want to call him, even he, in my opinion, his misguided and misinformed protests, even he's saying, how can you vote Hillary? Look at how corrupt this woman is. This woman is a joke. She shouldn't even be qualified to be a candidate for U.S. president. And I think that Americans are waking up to this. And the fake polls, the fake, you know, media that they try to skew that Clinton is winning. Even the first question, as you said, was like, oh, the first question at Hillary's press conference today was, oh, the latest polls have you actually up by 2 points on Trump nationally. But with all of Trump's, you know, negativity, shouldn't you run away with it? Run away with it. Donald Trump is the one that is running away with it. They knew what she would ask. They went to her question first. This is such an unbelievable psyop. America is waking up, though, and I think that Trump is going to dominate in a real election. Of course, we don't know if that's possible or
right,
not.
Right, because how could an election possibly be rigged? What does that even mean?
What does that even mean? Even though we're bringing in DHS and the UN, I don't know what a rigged election is. I worked for Acorn, who was caught dozens of times rigging elections. What's a rigged election?
Right.
What's a classified email?
Well, and the fact that the people aren't buying it anymore, we're going to get to that here in just a minute about this demon climate that is being created. We're going to get to some video. Julian Assange claiming it's a demon climate being created there to protect Hillary Clinton. All that and more is coming right up. Stick around. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. Now, here in a minute, we're going to be getting to this clip from Julian Assange where he is just blaming Clinton and the liberal press for creating this demonic climate and blaming things on Russian agents, all sorts of conspiracy theories. Nobody can believe anything that the media, the establishment media, is pushing it out there. No wonder 94% of the American public do not believe anything the media says. But before we get to that clip, I want to remind you guys, this is National Preparedness Month. We are having mega specials at the InfoWars store. Because of this, we're celebrating National Preparedness Month. We're giving you up to 40% off of all of our top-selling preparedness items. These are at InfoWarsStore.com. It's 30 to 40% off of InfoWars Select Storable Food, 20% off Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine, 20% off Alexa Pure air filters, and 20% off Alexa Pure water filters. So many other things there at the InfoWars store. Anything that has to do with preparedness, I mean, with everything that's going on in the world right now, it's more important than ever to start getting prepared for you and your family. I mean, even just you think the flooding that's been happening, or hurricanes, any of these natural disasters that are popping up, this is the time to get prepared. And, you know, you can always take this storable foods camping with you, simple things like that. But this is 40% off on all of our top selling preparedness products. And we're doing that as a huge thank you to everyone out there for supporting us here, supporting this operation. It's more important now than ever, as we're seeing the demise of the leftist media, to help prop up InfoWars and make sure that we remain the tip of the spear, you know, helping to drive this narrative. And this is just a huge thank you to you all. Help prepare for yourself and your family. That's 30 to 40% off right now while supplies last at InfoWarsStore.com. And now getting to sort of the demise of this leftist media, I mean, right now they're reporting about Arianna Huffington losing her place at the Huffington Post. And she was really created this entire media from nothing. And it became one of the top deals. Everyone knows the Huffington Post. And now it's been bought out and it's gone. And we can talk a little bit about that. It's just pretty evident. People are kind of shooting themselves in the foot by trying to protect their elite friends. Nobody trusts them anymore.
Well, and I think that this illustrates just the failing nature of the left right now is what Arianna Huffington stepping down from her little baby, the Huffington Post, is. But, you know, she talks about how the Huffington Post's goal was never to generate money. Of course, she's left. She's not a capitalist, probably a socialist. But it was chiefly political. And I think what she's kind of tongue-in-cheek, not even realizing that she's admitting, is that they had a political agenda. It's not about humanitarian. It's not about truth-based media. It's not even about capitalism. It's about their political agenda from the left, which has failed, which is why Arianna Huffington stepped down. She said that she wanted to, excuse me, Leanne, but she said she wanted to create a liberal version of the conservative online juggernaut Drudge Report. Now, this is what you're going to get on Huffington Post today. While the Drudge Report is kicking butt, on Huffington Post, be afraid of Donald Trump. Oh, his nightmare presidency. Then they twist. Says he'd fire generals. It's all a twist. It's all a big twist. The internet is having a great morning ripping apart Gary Johnson. You're 2 days late on that. InfoWars beat you on that. Lauer cowers, fails moderator test, going easy on Trump. Are you kidding me? Everybody that watched the debate. Trump keeps saying things that would destroy any other candidate. No, it's Clinton that if Trump did those things would destroy him. I mean, it's just, this is why you failed. This is why the left is failing. You're a bunch of lying frauds. You're a bunch of ignorant fools. Get out of this country.
Yeah, get on out. Well, and just the fact, if you go to any of their articles, at the bottom, there's a disclaimer about how much Trump sucks on every article. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Stick around.
He sucks for them.
Assange clip coming right up. And welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I am Leah McAdoo here, joined by Owen Schroyer. Owen says that he cannot bring us in like Alex Jones. Nobody is going to be able to bring us in and sing that song like Alex. Now, before the break, we were talking about this clip from WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange. He wanted to clarify some earlier statements he made. Everyone was like, he called Hillary Clinton a demon. Well, obviously, this was prior to her throwing up those little demon babies into her water, but
it's pretty accurate still.
Yeah, still. I mean, what are those demonic lozenges? But now he wants to go ahead and clarify his statement. So do we have that clip ready to go? Let's go.
The Hillary issue for a second. You did refer to or liken her to a demon, which I found amusing. But then you went on to say the American liberal press is falling all over themselves to defend Hillary Clinton, erecting a demon that is going to put nooses around everyone's neck as soon as she wins the election,
yep.
Which is almost certainly what she's going to do, meaning if she wins. I don't think anyone can accurately predict right now which way this election is going to go. That's my own personal opinion. What did you mean by that?
Well, it's a bit taken out of context by critics like the New York Times.
Of course.
I wasn't talking about Hillary Clinton as a person, but rather the climate that they are erecting. It is a demon, that climate. If Hillary Clinton is elected, then they have legitimized a climate of calling opposition leaders Russian agents, calling critical press Russian agents. Her campaign team has done it both for Mr. Trump,
saying Alex has a dark heart,
for the Greens candidate Jill Stein, and for The Intercept, another small investigative publisher in the United States. They are legitimizing that climate. When the New York Times, as a kind of standard bearer of the liberal press, says that's an okay thing to do for a ruling party candidate to come out and say that the opposition leaders and the press are foreign agents in order to turn around a domestic scandal, that's a really serious problem.
For the Hillary
Absolutely.
Issue.
Absolutely. And that, I mean, that was just like so poignant what he's saying, is that they're creating this climate that it's okay to just blame any scandal that happens on Russian agents, on this boogeyman, not looking at the fact that what was leaked in that DNC hack, which probably wasn't Russia. They have no evidence of it, but they want to just immediately blame it on Russia. Yeah, and Seth Rich and all that. They want to blame it on these Russian agents rather than looking at what was actually revealed. The fact that this entire election has been rigged, they stole the nomination from Bernie Sanders. They don't want anyone to look at that. And here he's saying that the press is basically digging their own grave.
Well, and Assange really is alluding to what's happening right now as far as foreign policy is being intermingled, which is where they want to, you know, start greasing the skids for war with Russia. I mean, that's all this is. Any chance they get to grease the skids and demonize Russia, they're going to do it. And even though Assange, I think, makes great points and, you know, he's got to take the high road here, I'll go ahead and speak out for what Assange. Hillary Clinton is a demon. Okay. That is a demon creature. I mean demon. I don't mean what climate or anything. I mean demon.
Yeah, she is a demon. And I love how she grabs her, like, empty cavity where her heart should be when she was talking about
her fake heart, probably some metal pig heart or something.
What kind of a dark heart would someone, I don't know. Why don't you ask Madeleine Albright what kind of a dark heart someone would have to have to talk about, you know, 500,000 dead Iraqi children was worth it. And she continues to tweet out how proud she is that Madeleine Albright is backing her. She backs her for president. Like, yeah, there's a voice that I want.
It's just hilarious to me. I mean, this is a woman who can be tied to deaths in Libya, deaths in, I mean, all Syria, kinds of death.
Iraq.
I mean, you talk about this corrupt government, corrupt wars. She can be tied to every single one of them. How is she demonizing anybody for having a black heart? You're the one with the black heart, you demon.
Look up Clinton body count. Donald Trump doesn't have a Trump body count.
Yeah. Right,
stick around. We're going to have Anthony Gucciardi joining us in the next segment.
If you are receiving this transmission, as the liners always say, you have chosen to engage in meaningful content. You have chosen to consciously listen to a program that's going to talk about real things and important things and not deflect and not talk about. It's clear that Hillary's in perfect health. She's spitting out green goo into cups and everything's totally fine. Everything is, in fact, amazing. Instead, we're going to talk about some real news, lots of news, jam-packed news, and we're going to keep Leanne and Owen to talk a little bit about it as well for this segment, including this piece that I just printed out and saw online. It's one of the top posts on Reddit. It's super bizarre. It almost seems like a satire piece or something. Bank of America says there's a 20 to 50% chance we're inside the Matrix and reality is just an artificial intelligence simulation. And they actually put this report out to investors, according to Business Insider, and said there is up to a 50% chance. They even have a graphic that everything is the Matrix, that we're all living in this artificial spectrum, and we should basically plan accordingly. So we're going to talk about that. Talk about in Japan how 541,000 young kids are recluse because they can't even enter society. They hate what society has become and how we're kind of going down that path in many ways. And a lot more things, you know, Hillary health, North Korea banned sarcasm, lots of stuff. Anyway, but first and foremost, I wanted to talk to you guys about the FDA ban on antibacterial soap. And here's why it's interesting. Okay. It's not just, oh, like antibacterial soap. Okay. No one really cares about that. It's way, way deeper than that. Last week, the FDA announced they were going to ban certain antibacterials in soap, which is good because triclosan, which is equivalent to some components in Agent Orange, is actually bad, right? But why would they do that now? Decades after we've been talking about it, decades after people have come on this program and said, hey, this stuff is actually bad for you. Is it because they just had a change of heart and they decided, you know what? Let's revisit that antibacterial stuff.
That is bad.
Right? I'm sure that's part of it. But guess what? Look at these stories. Superbugs are such a big issue. I mean, it is humanity ending issue. And more we see that superbugs are basically getting out and killing people. And I know people that own emergency centers and hospitals, and Dr. Group called me and said he's been getting a lot of doctors saying this too. So I just did a quick search and looked at some of this stuff. Look at all the news about superbugs that no one's talking about. Researchers find first U.S. bacteria with worrisome superbug genes. And I mean, that's been found before, but antibiotic resistant E. coli found in a quarter of chicken products sold at major supermarkets. Vice asks, is supermarket chicken going to kill us all?
Rare superbug outbreak in Wisconsin is blamed for 18 deaths. And how this happens is not only is 70% of antibiotics just dumped into livestock, so you're eating it in small micro amounts and it's mutating things, but antibacterial soap also. People are just rubbing that all over the body. How many times have you seen people with hand sanitizer just like rubbing their arms and stuff? I mean, it's like spreading superbugs. So that's why they're also doing that, is because they don't want to say, well, we did it because superbugs could wipe out humanity and, you know, it's an issue. They're just like, well, it could be dangerous. Mm-hmm. You know, what do you guys think about that?
Well, it's like, what are they going to do about all the antibiotics that they're pumping in all of the meat, and that they have to do that because they live in such disgusting conditions that they put our food supply in, they could wipe out the population there. So they're sanitizing our food before it even hits our bodies in that sense. I mean, what are they going to do about that? Or is this just the big move to push everyone into becoming vegetarians?
Well, and it's kind of like the out of sight, out of mind phenomenon when you talk about, you know, rubbing chemical agents or soap and then washing them down the drain, or even throwing a battery away that ends up eroding that shouldn't have been thrown away, you know, not throwing away a battery correctly. So it's this kind of like out of sight, out of mind thing that, oh, well, you know, the chemical runoff isn't in my house, or it's not in, you know, my county or wherever. Well, we're still in a self-contained environment, essentially, here. It's still on planet Earth. I mean, these chemicals are going somewhere, and most of the time they end up in our water, and that's why people are filtering their water if they have a brain in their head, because that's where most of this stuff ends up, Anthony, is right in our water. But they're not going to take the blame, you know, the people who put these chemicals in these products that we use every day, they're not going to take the blame when this stuff starts affecting all of us, when this stuff starts leaking into the water supply. No. They're not going to take the blame. In fact, the mainstream news is not even going to bring it up as an issue. It's just out of sight, out of mind.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, it's not a sexy issue, right? So we could talk about, and we are going to talk about other news that's, you know, more like, oh my God, like headline crazy. But it's not a sexy issue to talk about superbugs. It's not a sexy issue to talk about antibacterials. But there is that degree of faith, though, because the listeners of this show and this audience are actually super intelligent and actually look at things that are significant, you know. Mm-hmm. Think about why we've managed to actually change things. Think about why we've managed to push forward in new ways and develop basically news hijacking systems. It's because people listen to shows like this, the listeners right now, actually care. They actually care about meaningful content. They actually care about things that are important. They actually care about something that threatens humanity, like superbugs, right?
Right.
So it's not just fluff. That's exactly, so what Owen's saying, I agree, because the media instead would just say, oh, wow, there was 18 people that died in a superbug. It's scary from a superbug. Like, you better watch out or whatever. But they don't go the extra step in saying, wow, is it because there's so many antibiotics in the food supply? Is it because it's in the water supply? Is it because of all this? They don't go that extra step because they don't think you're smart enough.
Well, and they know.
They do not think you have the ability to transmogrify all that information and make a conscious decision. They just want to give you the little tidbit, like the little M&M, like, here you go.
Talking about wiping out.
I believe you do have that degree of intelligence, and I know you do.
Absolutely. And, you know, talking about that topic not being so sexy, well, the news is always talking anything that's about wiping out life on the planet as we know it, or World War III, they always want to talk about that. But with this particular topic that could actually wipe out life on the planet, but they're going to have to change so many structures, so many systems in order to do it. So they were not even going to tell people about it. So you have to take that step yourself.
And I think that this is something that's traceable. I think that these are companies that now are trying to kind of cover their tracks or you know, get out early. So when real news organizations like Infowars.com and all these other ones that are springing up, a lot of people are really just even focused in on like the health aspects, nutritional aspects, and what's going on with, you know, our biology and stuff like that. They're going to start seeing what's going on. These are traceable measurements we can make where we're saying, wow, look at these chemicals that are popping up in the water. Wow, look at these chemicals that are popping up in the food. They're not naturally supposed to be there. How are they getting there? Oh, okay, now we can trace back. Oh, this is part of a Agent Orange experience. Oh, Monsanto. Of course, most of this will probably trace back to Monsanto when you actually start to do this. But I think this is them starting to feel the heat. They know, Anthony, that people like you and InfoWars and other people are going to start reporting on this. And so they know that if this reaches a mainstream narrative, what are they going to do? They don't want to be caught with their tail between their legs when cancer rates go from, you know, 1,000% each increase in 20 years to a 20,000% increase in the next 20 years.
Right.
You know, it's a matter of just saying, and we're about to talk about this Zika story too. It's a matter of just saying, look at the magnifying lens that the media has, right? It has this big magnifying lens. And you think about maybe 50 years ago, it was the only big magnifying lens. And there's like these people just carrying it around, right? And then there's the whole country just standing there, and they can just put their big magnifying lens on something, and everyone just sees that, right? Mm-hmm. So maybe 50, 60 years ago. So they would just say, well, look at this over here. This is most important. Don't worry about all that other stuff, okay? Don't worry about that. That's non-existent. Just
look over
here.
Yeah, non-existent, exactly.
Right? But now we have a big magnifying glass, and we're like, well, look at this. Look over here. And people can actually choose what they're looking at.
Right.
But the media still desperately, and when I said the media, many of the mainstream media organizations that have lost all credibility and 94% distrust them, have their little magnifying glass, and they're like, look, Zika's bad, though. And look at the freak out over that.
So, and then we're like, look who owns the patent on Zika. And they're like, no, it's, don't look at that.
Yeah, well, these are Rockefeller and Big Pharma-funded news agencies. So what do you expect?
Well, you know, beyond all that, though, right? So beyond all the whole, like, the dark loomingness, all we have to do is look at the top. Look at the cream on top. Look at this craziness. Aerial spraying for Zika stirs controversy in Miami Beach. They're spraying Miami Beach. I don't know if anyone, if you guys have ever been to Miami Beach. Imagine just dousing Miami Beach in insecticide. That's what they're
right.
doing.
Yeah.
Over a 1.5 square mile infection zone. Like, they're just like, oh, Zika. Everyone's freaking out about Zika. If you go to Google, it's always the top trend. Like, do I have Zika? And it's all these people not anywhere near the Zika virus thinking they have Zika. And a friend of mine who runs urgent care centers, hospitals and stuff, he's like, no, everyone's coming in saying, I have Zika. I'm going to die. Like, what am I going to do? And guess what? It's because the mainstream media saying Zika, it's so scary. Like, you right. watch the nightly news and they say Zika virus, 4 new patients found with minor symptoms, you know, like
right.
they freak out about it. But then when we talk about real stuff, because this audience actually cares about the real stuff and pushes it out, and it's like, hey, let's make this the top trend. And you see on Twitter, on Facebook, whatever, it's all the top trends are generally like the important stuff we push.
Mm-hmm.
But still, the media will take that magnifying lens and say, well, don't worry about that.
Right.
That doesn't matter.
Well,
Zika is scary.
Well,
and then the government sprays the beaches because yeah. it's the worst thing ever.
And the pesticide that they're spraying is more damaging, more harmful to pregnant women developing fetuses than the Zika virus that they're probably not even going to get. And so all those pesticides and poison are now getting into the water, running off into the groundwater. I mean, it is
in
absolute insanity.
Well, I don't know if either of you guys saw this, but the day after they sprayed all the Zika aerosols, or it was either the day after
right.
or the day of, thousands of bees
Millions.
Died immediately.
Millions.
It was like the bee apocalypse. So right. think about it. If they don't want to eliminate, you know, humanity just by killing us all, well, then we'll just kill all the bees, and then humanity will eventually die off
it's
because
like
that's how the food chain works.
President Camacho from Idiocracy, it's like, we have a serious problem, sir. What do we do? He's like, well, just spray all the beaches and just kill all the bees.
Spray them all.
Just
annihilate everything.
All right, guys, we'll be back with more news. Leanne and Owen, thank you, guys. Stay tuned, fourth hour. Lots more coming up. All right, welcome back. It is the fourth hour of the Alex Jones Show. I'm Anthony Gucciardi, and what we're going to do is we've got so many special reports that Alex didn't get a chance to play, and I know he did want to play them because they are good. So we're going to go to this report by John Bowne about Hillary and what's going on with that. And then we'll come back and more news, including, are we living in the Matrix? Bank of America says probably. Crazy stuff.
Hello, Neil.
Who are you?
I am the architect. I created the Matrix.
Just how deep does the Matrix of the programming of the general public go? Would it surprise you to discover just how subtle and obvious the programming truly is? Back in 2011, InfoWars spoke with Cuban-born journalist Alex Abella about the RAND Corporation's infiltration of the American psyche.
What RAND actually did during the 1950s is that they came up with this particular way of looking at the world that changed everything, that changed the world we live in, that changed how we think, how we talk, the schools we send our kids to, how we pay our taxes, the planes we fly in. They've changed the whole world. They developed something called rational choice theory that after it came up and after it was developed and expanded, it turned us from citizens into consumers. And instead of having rights and responsibilities, we became consumers with choices. In a world where what really counts is what they call the consumer sovereignty, or the sovereignty of the consumer, where what counts is not what we do, or who we believe in, or what God we pray to, but how much money are we going to spend? And what's in it for me?
Choice. The problem is choice.
The rational choice theory has gradually been inundated in American culture for at the very least five generations.
The Matrix is older than you know. I prefer counting from the emergence of one integral anomaly to the emergence of the next, in which case this is the sixth version.
The RAND Corporation is at the heart of the New World Order. It's part of that inner coterie, or almost a group of ring-wraith organizations that serve this dark system. And the RAND Corporation, literally, if you research the white papers they put out that are public, has set the policy that we are now living under in this country, and they have the nerve to locate themselves and get the street named 1776.
Simply put, it's far easier to control a nation of mindless consumers than free-thinking individuals with strong beliefs. Globalist think tanks, the RAND Corporation, the CFR, hand-in-hand with the CIA and the Pentagon, have developed and customized unyielding psyops on the American people, bringing us to the state of dysfunction we all experience today. After leaving the Washington Post in 1977, Carl Bernstein wrote for Rolling Stone. In 1953, Joseph Alsop, then one of America's leading syndicated columnists, went to the Philippines to cover an election. He did not go because he was asked to do so by his syndicate. He did not go because he was asked to do so by the newspapers that printed his column. He went at the request of the CIA. Alsop is one of more than 400 American journalists who in the past 25 years have secretly carried out assignments for the Central Intelligence Agency, according to documents on file at CIA headquarters. Fast forward to the present day, and those same meddling internal forces have grown a mutated psyop into monstrous proportions in the form of Black Lives Matter. The Washington Times recently revealed that the Ford Foundation and Borealis Philanthropy recently announced the formation of the Black-Led Movement Fund, BLMF, a six-year pooled donor campaign aimed at raising $100 million for the Movement for Black Lives Coalition. That funding comes in addition to more than $33 million in grants to the Black Lives Matter movement from top Democratic Party donor George Soros through his Open Society Foundations, as well as grant making from the Center for American Progress.
Well, yes. I mean, there has been always a link between think tanks and the big powerful economic interests. Specifically, in the case of RAND, there's been a link between RAND and the Ford Foundation.
The Ford Foundation has been providing cover as a CIA funding arm since the Cold War, and Borealis Philanthropy has been expanding funding to bring in an invasion of illegal immigrants into the United States, raising over $90 million in 8 years. America is being eaten away from the inside out, and it's getting easier and easier as more and more Americans isolate themselves from their fellow citizens and their inherited responsibility to be mindful of the overwhelming evidence that we are being smothered under a blanket of globalism. John Bound for Infowars.com.
You know, whether you decide to or not consciously, every single day you are choosing a so-called side, right? It's not that black and white. But with everything you do, whether it's you wake up and you brush your teeth and you go to Starbucks, you buy a Starbucks coffee, you go to the gas station, you're making a choice to support something, right? So you're buying that Starbucks coffee, you're buying food from a certain store, like a certain outlet, you're working for a certain corporation, you're putting your time, you're putting your energy into something, but also the content you consume. So if you go on YouTube, for example, you're giving views to things. It's kind of trivial and small in a way, but guess what? It actually matters. You're choosing to consume something. So just as you would like drink a water, you're consuming this content right now. You're consuming that. So when you go on YouTube and you're consuming worthless content, which we all do sometimes, but I mean, you're supporting organizations you don't believe in, you're supporting content you don't believe in, That also is a choice. I'm not saying everyone's bad if they do that, right? But by choosing something meaningful, even if you don't agree with every single thing about it, right, you are actually making a difference in supporting something, whether it is just giving it views or supporting it or spreading the word or whatever. And also, when you make a financial purchase, you make voting with your dollar is a very real thing. I mean, that's how companies are started. So why not support a good organization you actually believe in that's doing something that is on the front lines, willing to sacrifice, willing to fund itself, willing to take heat over your Starbucks coffee? So I bring this up as the preparedness mega specials, InfoWars, store.com, InfoWarsLife.com. This is a good time to get a lot off on storable food, which is something that everyone should have anyway. I have a ton of it at my house. There's a ton of it at the office. Alex actually bought it for his whole crew. 20% off Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine, which is the best flagship iodine from InfoWars Life. I mean, the benefits are numerous. You're probably already aware. Check it out, InfoWarsLife.com, 20% off. 20% off Lexapure air filters, 20% off the water filters, and there's more specials. I mean, you can find something, right? You can find something for 20% off. It's a decent, good special that is going to actually empower you as opposed to disempowering you. Because when you support something like Starbucks, what do they give you? What value do they give you? They get to open up more chains. They get to support things you probably don't believe in. But the opposite is true at InfoWarsStore.com. Up to 40% off. Support something you actually believe in. Now, let's talk about this. This is quite an interesting story. It makes me feel like I am in the Matrix. Bank of America, there's a 20 to 50% chance we're inside the Matrix and reality is just a simulation. It's always weird when a group like Bank of America says this. This is from Business Insider. In a note to clients out Tuesday, Bank of America Merrill Lynch said there's a 20 to 50% chance that we're living in the Matrix, meaning that the world we experience as, quote, real is actually just a simulation. This the firm cites comments from Elon Musk, Neil deGrasse Tyson, and Nick Bostrom's seminal paper on the issue as the basis for its 20 to 50% view. Now, first of all, that's pretty funny, right? How could you possibly quantify a percentage? I guess you could look at the probable advancements in technology and artificial intelligence and say, well, you know, down the road we could get there. But I'd like to see how they came up. Unless this is all a big joke somehow, by the way, which I'm totally open to, but it doesn't appear to be. 50% chance we're in a matrix. That sounds like an interesting quantification. They say many scientists, philosophers, and business leaders believe that there is a 20 to 50% probability that humans are already living in a computer-simulated virtual world. In April 2016, researchers gathered at the American Museum of Natural History to debate this notion. The argument is that we are already approaching photorealistic 3D simulations that millions of people can simultaneously participate in. Says that it is conceivable with the advancements in artificial intelligence, virtual reality, and computing power, members of future civilizations could have decided to run a simulation of their ancestors. Says that notably highlights their probable scenarios for the human race, which are extinction before reaching a post-human stage, reaching a post-human existence but not simulating, and that we're already in the Matrix already. So, in other words, and it even has a nice little graph here. A nice little graph about the probability of our existence inside the Matrix. Well, you know, I think we are in a Matrix. I don't know if I'm not sure it's a virtual reality simulation, but I feel like I'm in a Matrix most days because sanity has turned into insanity, right? I feel like instead of a virtual reality Matrix, and again, I don't know where they get these percentages from, like 50% chance everything is not real. I think there could be an ethereal type matrix, like multiple dimension systems and everything like that, which is not the topic we're going to discuss right now, which could then be perceived as like a virtual reality in some ways through scientific exploration. But anyway, instead, I would argue that we are in a micro matrix because every single day when I wake up and I look at the news, I see complete insanity. As an example, I get some of my news from Reddit, which is a hugely popular website. And if I go to world news versus U.S. news, right? So you click world news, and it's oftentimes like big events, like weird stuff like this, like North Korea bans sarcasm because Kim Jong-un fears people only agree with him ironically, like crazy stuff or like, you know, World War III type scenarios, troops moving on the Ukrainian border, whatever. But when I click U.S. News, maybe we could even go to Reddit. And it just says news up there. When I click news, it's almost like I went from real news that actually has some significance in my life. If we click news up the top, it's always like, UMass students, Harambe jokes are an attack on African Americans, Black Lives Matter law used, innocent, like all this stuff about race and like just division. It's just a joke, man. It's just a joke. It's absurd. If we look at the real news, world news, it's all stuff about real issues, stuff that actually matters. Courts deciding things, precedents. I've got this piece here about stingray use. I've got stuff about Hillary Clinton, you know, the Japanese people in their house that are reclusive because their society's collapsing. But then the U.S. news is just, this race is mad. This race is mad. Microaggressions here. Someone's upset and it's your fault. Okay. It's all just shaming you. And the worst thing in the world is to feel shame all the time. And I feel like it's 100% true. We're in a matrix. We're in a matrix of artificial reality pushed on us, where we're not allowed to talk about the things that matter, because instead we must be pushed into a micro prison, into a little playpen. And that's what the U.S. news has come. That is why more people than ever are like accepting foreign news sources. Think about that 20, 30 years ago. Who would go to Russian television? Who would ever say, well, you know, I'm going to go watch Russian state-sponsored television now for my news since I believe it's more credible? What? Absolutely not. What a pathetic state we are in which a decent percentage and number of people say, I'm going to watch Russian state-sponsored news because I don't trust the U.S. media. And it's because it's turned into the way I would describe U.S. media and the people propagating it, the people that buy into it, is everyone is in a sumo wrestler suit with pads and like big like pool tubes or something, and they're all just attacking each other. And like it's a safe space, though, like little toddlers in a pen, and they're all just crying at each other and like, oh, my God. And no one is allowed to come in and say, hey, you know, this is all just a weird stage little like playpen thing. What are you guys doing? They're just like, oh, he hurt me. He hurt my feelings. I got upset at that. And the only thing that's going to lead us to is implosion. And I don't mean implosion on we're going to be starving on the streets. I mean intellectual, cultural, society implosion, in which it will invert in a very bad way. And I've been saying that for a very long time, in the sense that the focus on not offending everyone, like New York Times wrote an article that was actually pretty good about the new indoctrination of students in college, like introductory events, like assemblies or whatever. And they were telling them, like, remember, if you say you guys, that could be offensive. We know about that political correctness stuff, right? So what's going to happen, though, is that's going to create actual hate and racism. Because as an example, yesterday night, I get a phone call from someone. It's a friend of mine. And they said, you know, Anthony, I like to talk to you because I feel like I can say things to you and you won't get upset at me. I said, what do you mean? And they said, well, you know, I talk to a bunch of people every single day. It's part of my job. But if I say anything that offends them at all, when it's not offensive, and I promise I'm not trying to be mean, I don't know what to do. They get so upset. And I was like, what do you mean? And they were like, well, you know, this woman came in and I didn't mean to say it. I didn't mean to say it. She just, you know, she was of a certain ethnicity. I just said, you know, that black woman, I didn't mean it racist. And everyone got mad. And I was like, well, you were just identifying the person, to be clear, because there was a white woman and a black woman in the waiting room. So you just said black woman, right? And she goes, yeah, and I didn't mean anything by it. I'm serious. I was like, what? what? I mean, clearly you're not being racist, clearly. But what happens is no one actually believes, besides a small percentage of people, that's racist. No one actually believes that those microaggressions are really evil, right? So what happens is it's an inversion. It's almost like, when you law of gravity, it applies to society. When you jump up really high on a trampoline, you're going to fall back down. And if the trampoline is not there and it's a bunch of cement, you're going to get hurt. Okay? So what happens is we obsess over this stuff. We obsess over it. We're just like, oh my God, stop offending people. You're not allowed to do this. And everyone, besides a small majority, actually a minority, doesn't believe it. So they start rebounding, and it actually creates real racism. It actually creates real hate because people reject that whole ideology and they go extreme farther. It's already been seen in Europe. There's actually a bunch of real hate groups rising in popularity because of the fact that everyone is just saying, oh, the refugees are awesome. We love them, which isn't good, but hating them is not good either. There is an actual reality zone in between those two where you don't have to hate, but you don't also have to let everybody walk all over you. But the problem is that is reason. And reaching reason is very, very challenging in a frenzied, insane world. So I, in fact, would argue that we are living in a form of the Matrix. Maybe Bank of America is right. Yeah, the coddling of the American mind by the Atlantic, that's a good one too. Basically, kids are just brought up and told that they need to get offended by everything. And they need to get upset. And don't worry about real stuff. And I have an article here, actually, about real stuff that I like to talk. I like to talk about real things. I'm going to find it. It's about child marriage in Nepal. And here it is. Girls face shattered dreams as Nepal fails to curb child marriage. Now, let me tell you something. I am unequivocally 100% for the empowerment of women, for the empowerment of men, for the empowerment of humanity. There's no debate, no question about that. I say that 100% real, and I want to empower everyone. Now, does that mean that I get triggered when someone uses a gender-specific term? No. Does that mean I get upset when someone says something that doesn't fall in line with the exact politically correct ideology that has been forced down my throat as a form of thought and word domination? No, it doesn't. It does mean, though, that I get upset when I read articles like this, which we should be upset about. This article should be the top priority in all of the social justice warriors' minds. Should be top priority. They should be thinking about real stuff. So check this out. Kapila Wosti, I'm not sure the pronunciation, was just 14 when her father married her off to a stranger who was 5 years older. A year later, she gave birth to a baby girl. By the time she was 20, she had 3 children. Okay, at 14 years old, shipped off to a stranger to be married. The first time I became pregnant, she says, I was not even aware I was going to be a mother and did not know how to raise the child. She said, now 34, as she sat cross-legged on the floor of a sheltered home in Nepali capital. Separated from her husband over a decade, Wosti blames the marriage for ruining her life, denying her the chance of going to school and choosing a more suitable partner. So she can't go to school, can't choose her partner. She's forced to marry someone at age 14 and bear children. There are women of my age who are yet to have children, said the petite woman, dressed in a green shirt and trousers with her long black hair tied up in a bun. I could have gone to school and had a better future too, but all that is a dream now, she told Thomson Reuters. Child marriage is illegal in Nepal, yet the impoverished Himalayan nation has failed to put in place policies to curb the practice, with almost 40% of girls married before age 18, obviously told to be married, shipped off and said, marry this person and bear their children and whatever happens, oh well. It found that poverty, compounded by illiteracy and society's disapproval of unmarried women, compelled many parents to seek out husbands for their daughters. Yet, child marriage often results in a vicious cycle of malnutrition, poor health, and ignorance, since a child bride is more likely to drop out of school and experience problems during pregnancy and childbirth. Her children are more likely to be underweight or die before the age of 5, said the report based on 100 interviews with children, former child brides, parents, and activists. Now, that is actually sad. That is actually real challenge. That's like real life, okay? That's actually an issue. That's actually very, very disturbing. Think about sending a 14-year-old girl off who has no idea how to raise a child, doesn't know about nutrition, they don't know anything at this point, shipped off because it's bad for women in society in Nepal not to be married, and it looks bad for the family. It's illegal, but they're doing it anyway, right? Now, yeah, I know that's Nepal. It's not the United States of America. Okay, I get that. But as things, a million times worse than this happened in Saudi Arabia, as things a million times worse than this happen in the United States, in neighboring countries, in Mexico, where is the outcry? It's right here. You guys are upset. Everyone listening right now is upset. You guys are sharing it. You're making it trend. It is actually being pushed. But how come there's this little membrane, this little weird membrane of the so-called social justice warriors, which I think is a much too flattering term for people that would rather get upset about gender terminologies than forced child marriage or the horrible, horrible mistreatment of women and children in certain countries that we would never be able to discuss. Why is that membrane not allowing this stuff in? Why is it only little self-serving BS? Well, dare I say that many of those people that are such warriors for the cause, it's not about empowering the women or empowering the young girls. It's about getting upset and attacking people. Because, you see, attacking generally doesn't do much. What it does is it just makes you feel better. So when you see those little Twitter wars and, like, people attacking, like, oh, you are a piece of crap, cisgendered, blah, blah, blah. Is it really because they want to empower women? Because I want to empower women. I truly do. I want to empower everybody. I want to empower everyone in my life, in a microcosm, in the grand scheme of things. Why do we talk about all this stuff? At least we try. At least we care. That's real empowerment. It's not sitting around screaming and shouting in weird grunting noises about oppression of the patriarchy cisgendered scum. Not that there's not real oppression, not there's not real sexism, but we should talk about real issues like this, like child sex slavery and the abuse of women, not getting triggered on Twitter. We'll be back. More news, final segment. This is the Alex Jones Show, fourth hour. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. Stay tuned. It seems like the most damaging things tend to shut down or kind of muffle our basic instincts and development and just things that we have as a people, as a humanity, right? We've just always intrinsically have figured out through trial and error or development. And this piece from the Japan Times, Japan home to 541,000 young recluses, survey finds. You know, is that a preview of what's to come or what's already happening in the United States or wherever you're listening? I think absolutely yes. It says an estimated 541,000 people aged between 15 and 39 in Japan avoid social contact and shut themselves in their homes, according to a government survey released Wednesday. Now, why are they doing that? It doesn't take a rocket scientist to know that Japan, in so many ways, is progressed further than the United States in some technological advancements, right? But people are more locked into that tech grid also. And what happens is we lose basic instinct function when we don't develop ourselves at all. So people, kids rather, I guess, but if you're 15 years old and you've only grown up through the only existential kind of communication you've had with another human being is through chat or through texting or through, you know, watching porn or something, your brain is not going to be wired properly. So what happens is people just decide not to go out. People decide not to communicate. It's a self-inflicted mental wound and developmental instinctual wound on ourselves. And that is why, unfortunately, you see some people, it's like you even talk to people and they freak out. You talk to people, they freak out. I mean, hey, I'm guilty myself. Sometimes I'll sit on the computer for so long and I'll like go outside, like, oh my God, right? It's getting warped into that system. And you go outside and there are people that, unfortunately, guess what? They're on hardcore like medications and stuff, and they just walk around and it's sad to say what they really look like and how they interface. You go up to people on the street and you say, you ask for directions or something, they look at you like you're a crazy person. You are insane if you can talk. I mean, even going to stores now, like I went to check out at some store or whatever, and I just started having a conversation with the guy, and he was just like, what? Like, he was like, it's like 5:23. I'm like, cool, thanks, man. So how you doing today? He's like, I'm good. It's 5:23. Like, yeah, I know that. I know the price. I caught that. You know, I swiped the car. I'm just asking how you're doing. He's like, I'm good. Good. Like, he was really freaked out that I asked how he was doing, because I'm sure that for the last, you know, however many months or years he's worked there, most people just come in and they're just like, come up, and he's like, 5:23, and they're like, swipe their card, say nothing, maybe say thank you, grab the bag, leave. And he just does that over and over again for 8 hours every day. So when someone comes and wants to communicate with this person, and I actually want to know, you know, maybe he has something interesting to say, how's your day going? That is craziness. And it's because we've entered the society in which we sit and we observe. We become an observant society of observing people, like reading articles about our favorite celebrities and like just watching YouTube videos of people speaking to us, which is not bad, right? We can learn stuff from these things. But the problem is we're not interacting. There is a screen. There is a shield in between us. There is an artificial system layer in between interaction to where human interaction is now weird. And it's a scary thing. All right, Alex will be back tomorrow from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central. Go to InfoWarsStore.com. Support meaningful content. Up to 40% off on storable food. 20% off X2 Survival Shield. Nascent iodine. It's going to end soon, so now's the chance. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com. And once again, Alex will return tomorrow, 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central.